head coach Joe Anderson in his fourth year brings a strong and experienced team to the state finals. His Pirate offense is led by junior tailback David Rogge with over 1,300 yards. Cambridge's Dan Kieser in his 17th and final year as head coach feels his balanced offense is the key. His Trojan quarterback Wade Vaunce runs the show, throwing for almost 1,200 yards. We'll crown the C2 champ next. Stadium in Lincoln for a real interesting matchup in Class C2. The Plainview Pirates haven't been in a title game since 1975. Nobody on this roster remembers that game. But for Cambridge, there are some folks on this roster from their last title team, a very experienced team. They won it here in 2003. They're looking to win it again. But, Aide, you look at this Plainview team. Haven't been here since 1975. Joe Anderson, the head coach, really making some big strides.
He has really done a remarkable job to turn this program around, Kevin. He lost games his first 2 years, losing seasons, turned it around last year, 8-3, 10-2 this year, an appearance in the state finals this year, looking for that championship. He has really done it with a powerful offense, led by Harrison Lingenfelter. Offensive tackle, son of Bob Lingenfelter, really is the leader up front. He protects for Blake Moselle, their quarterback, 3-year starter. A lot of experience here, a lot of leadership, a lot of intellect in the offense. On defense, well, they are very, very tough. They stop the run very well. Their secondary is especially good. They've given up just 10 points a game this year. It's a very tough football team on both sides of the football, but there's a lot at stake here for them and for Cambridge. Cambridge has a lot of emotion on their side of the football. Plainview's going to give a good run, though.
Should be a great one today. Also working with us, again, we have it well covered. Former Husker Damon Benning joins us for the day. And, Damon, it's interesting to look at this Cambridge team. Veteran observers of Cambridge are going to be surprised. They do a lot of different things on offense.
Absolutely. I think that people familiar with Cambridge's style are used to seeing him in that wishbone, very ground-oriented attack. This year, Coach Kieser has really understood his personnel and understood that, you know, the key that makes this car drive is Wade Vaunce, who is a 3-year starter for him, a three-sport superstar. He's designed this offense around what Wade does well, almost 1,200 yards passing, accounted for almost 600 yards rushing, a very diversified offensive attack. Should be tough to stop. Anytime you can come out in a wishbone type set and then turn around and come with a 5-wide, tough to handle.
Well, it should be a lot of fun here this afternoon, and again, we've got it well covered. Larry Putney joins us on the field with more. Larry.
Well, Kevin, and one of the storylines we'll be covering down here is this is the final game of a 26-year head coaching career for Dan Kieser, one of the good guys of coaching in Nebraska high school coaching. This is his 8th state championship game. He tries to go out on top in his final game as a coach.
One of the great guys in coaching and trying to go out a winner one more time in his final game at Cambridge. Cambridge and Plainview getting set to start. And let's head over to our public address announcer, Dwight Wanniger. He'll introduce you to the participants in this C2 title game.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Nebraska School Activities Association, its member schools and U.S. Bank, welcome to Memorial Stadium for the 2005 Class C2 State Championship Game. Today's game features the Plainview High School Pirates versus the Trojans of Cambridge High School. And now, let's meet today's starting lineups. First for the visiting team, the Pirates of Plainview High School. Number 5, Grant Rutledge. Number 9, Blake Mosel. Number 11, Tom Johnson. Number 17, Philip Hamilton. Number 21, Keelan Anderson. Number 24, Brett Groff. Number 26, Jack Pudens. Number 30, David Rogge. Number 42, Michael Stelling. number 44, Nicholas Yostin. Number 52, Jace Kluver. Number 54, Chance Anderson. Number 55, Sean Meyer. Number 63, Derek Getz. Number 68, Luke Lingenfelder. Number 74, Harrison Lingenfelder. Number 82, Brent Walken. The head coach for Plainview is Joe Anderson. And now, please welcome the rest of the Pirates to the field.
Well, watching the Plainview Pirates run out, it's obvious one thing Plainview has, and they have it in abundance on the lines, and that's size. The Lingenfelter brothers, very big. You've got Sean Meyer in there at 265 pounds. There's good size for Plainview on those offensive and defensive lines.
Kevin, you look at Meyer at 265, Lingenfelter at 265. They are the starting guards. Kluver at 225. The other Lingenfelter, Luke at 215 at the left tackle, and then Chase Anderson, the other tackle, the right tackle at 210. Excellent size up there. And not only that, they can move and move well. So that is two key elements for their offensive line. Like we said before, they control that front. They want to control the football in front, and nothing fancy, just pop away 4, 5, 6 yards of crack and make things happen for their offense.
They'll try to lean on you, and we'll see if they're able to do that against the Cambridge Trojans. And back to our public address announcer, Dwight Weininger, to introduce you to Cambridge.
And now for the home team, the Trojans of Cambridge High School. Number 7, Josh Keener. Number 11, Jackson Johnson. Number 12, Wade Vaunce. Number 20, Brett Trebelli. Number 22, Lance Shiflett. Number 24, Bo Crabelli. Number 30, Anthony Lytle. Number 31, Brian Ballou. Number 32, Daniel Craven. Number 41, Mason Jackson. Number 55, Jared Sewell. Number 61, Davin Doyle. Number 62, Taylor Lewis. Number 64, Jarrell Alexander. Number 67, Bronson Susi. Number 70, Aaron Coe. Number 73, Anthony Hopkins. Number 74, Dustin Ware. Number 76, Jacob Langley. Number 79, James Hobbs. Number 82, Jacob Benson. Number 88, Dylan Mowry. The head coach for Cambridge is Dan Keyser. And now, please welcome the rest of the Cambridge Trojans to the field.
Cambridge at 10-2,
trying for another state championship. And Damon, I know Wade Vaughns gets a lot of the hype for Cambridge and a lot of the talk, but I know you've been impressed also with Anthony Lytle, their tailback.
Absolutely. He's been their jack of all trades this year. They throw him the football. They give it to him out of the backfield via the handoff. And he's a talented runner. Cambridge is going to have to do a good job of at least establishing some sort of ground game to keep the Pirates honest here up front.
Well, Larry Putney's got a nasty habit of hanging around in locker rooms before these games, and I think he was down in the locker room again of one of these teams. Let's find out what's going on down on the field.
Well, we were in the Cambridge locker room, and you know, Kevin, they talk about how a team takes on the characteristics of its head coach, and Dan Keyser is a really low-key guy, very principled, doesn't get his team too fired up, and you could even see it on the introductions there. The players very stoic. They obviously very focused and ready to play the game. And throughout the week, the coaches that I talked to and the assistant coaches have said Keyser has not mentioned at one point this being his last game, winning over the coach, and he's just not that kind of guy. But you could clearly tell in the locker room that everybody was aware Coach Keyser's last game is today.
Well, and we asked him, thanks, Larry, we asked him about it before the game, and I said, is it an emotional week? And he says, only when people ask me about it. He's a very good man. We'll talk more about that throughout the broadcast. The 2005 Nebraska State High School Football Championships are being carried live over the internet. So if you have friends or family who don't have access to NET, have them log on to netnebraska.org, click sports, and follow the prompts to State High School Football. NET is Nebraska's home for sports.
There, behind you is Mr. Ashoff, the line judge. Over here is Mr. Oman, the linesman, and Mr. Holling, the back judge. Guys, if you've got any questions during the game, talk to us, all right? Captains, you're in charge of your team. We're counting on good sportsmanship. If we got anything you can be concerned about, we're going to come to you and you take care of it, all right? We don't want to have any penalties like that. All right, Plainview, you're the visiting team. Ordinary 50-cent piece. We're going to flip it. Who's going to call it? Call it, please. He called a tail. It is a head. You've won the toss, Cambridge. You'll take the ball.
The Cambridge Trojans will be on offense first. We'll get a chance to look at that diverse offense of Cambridge as they'll start off the game with the football. The C2 title game is next on NET Sports. Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, the C2 state championship about to begin. Cambridge and Plainview, where did they come from and how did they get here? Well, here's the map. Plainview, northeastern Nebraska. You see Cambridge in south central Nebraska making their way to converge here in Lincoln for the C2 title game. And the road to the championship, Plainview with a win over Hardington Central Catholic and also over Scribner-Snyder. Close games for Plainview. Cambridge blowing out North Platte St. Pat's, which beat them earlier in the year, and beat Thayer Central 29-9. The weather today, a little warmer than we had yesterday for the first day of the state championships, 41 degrees this afternoon. The wind now up to 43 degrees, sunny skies, southwest wind at 12 miles per hour, and 66% humidity expected to reach a high today of about 48 here in Lincoln as Plainview and Cambridge are about to get this one kicked off.
Plainview needs to guard against a fast start by Cambridge here, Kevin. They'll have the ball first, obviously. We'll talk about that right after this kickoff.
And the C2 title game is underway. It's a low kickoff. Lytle trying to scoop it up at the 15-yard line. Lytle, not a lot of room then after the low bouncing kick. Luke Lingenfelter down to make the stop. And Cambridge will start in a hole. And let's look at the offense for the Cambridge Trojans. The backs and receivers, Wade Vaughns, Anthony Lytle, Mason Jackson, Jacob Benson, Brian Ballew, and Brent Crivelli. The offensive line, Anthony Hopkins, Dustin Webb, Jared Sewell, Bronson Susi, and Aaron Coe on the offensive line. And there's a good look at Wade Vaughns, the quarterback, 6'2", 200-pound senior, the golf champ, All-State in basketball, All-State in football. He can do it all. They'll empty the backfield on first down. Throw the screen pass. Shiflett on the outside. Breaks a couple of tackles, and Shiflett has a first down out to the 31-yard line. And there's a pretty good start for Cambridge. First play and a 14-yard gain defensively for the Plainview Pirates. Into this title game, Luke Lingenfelter, Sean Meyer, Derek Getz, and Harrison Lingenfelter. Backs and linebackers, Nicky Osten, Michael Stelling, David Aragi, Keelan Anderson, Brett Groff, Philip Hamilton, and Blake Mozell. The backs and linebackers for Plainview. First down and 10 from the 31-yard line. Again, empty out the backfield, throw that screen. It's tipped and incomplete. Harrison Lingenfelter, same setup, trying to toss it to Shiflett on the right side, and Lingenfelter there to swat it away.
6'4", he got that big left mid up and knocked it out. I talked about the fast start by Cambridge in the first round against Garden County, Kevin. They won that ball game 37-6, but in their first 10 plays from scrimmage, Cambridge scored three times, and so that's what Plainview really needs to guard against here. And Cambridge came out that first play, picked up a first down, but Lingenfelter knocked that ball down on the last play.
Second down and 10 from the 31. Shiflett in motion, throw a little quick slant, and Brian Ballew, the tight end, unable to pull it in, and it's third down and 10.
It's interesting how Cambridge has used the variations of the same play three different times. The first time, nobody from Plainview went with the motion man. The second time, they got it to the tailback, and this time the motion man widened, and they tried to slip it to the tight end underneath. Three well-conceived plays right here so far early from Coach Kieser.
And Damon, three pass plays, too, which is pretty unusual.
Out of the shotgun, four wide receivers into the pattern. Flags are down, and we're going to have a movement call, looks like. False start against Cambridge, and that may cost him five and send it back to the 26-yard line. As you look at the officials, our referee is Alan Yanovic, Jason Gall, Dave Ullman, Tim Ashoff, and John D. Holling, the officials today for this C2 title game.
Talk about the pass, Damon, because when you look at their numbers on the year, they've rushed for an average of 265 yards a game and passed for 96. Not bad balance, actually, but now they were going to throw number four here in this series. So four straight balls in the air to start the ball game.
Third down and 15. Shiflett in motion. Vaughn's looking to throw. Firing, and it's dropped at the 45-yard line. He had Jacob Benson, and he threw it right on the money, but Benson couldn't pull it in.
Make it five now. Go ahead, Evan.
Well, conceptually, as you take a look at the replay, again, the same motion with the tailback as Plainview widens. Coach Kieser knows exactly what he wants to do out of that, I guess, inverted 50 or 44 look. It'll be hard for Plainview to handle those guys in the slots up the hashes.
Yeah, they're running six people down linemen as far as defense goes. Two backers and then the secondary. Three people back there. You're going to have a bit of a hole at times. And Cambridge has found it but not able to complete the pass.
A punt and a pretty good one angling toward the sideline and out of bounds. And Plainview will start in good field position right near midfield, where the Pirates will have their first offensive possession. In last year's C2 championship game, North Platte St. Patrick's was looking for a bit of luck to go their way. St. Pat's was down 6-0 to Stanton in the fourth quarter. Let's flash back to late in the 2004 C2 championship game. Second down, 21. New formation with Nicolai taking the snap. Nicolai rolling to throw. He's in trouble. Nicolai has the ball, pop free, still loose on the turf. Bobbled into the end zone. Who's going to come up with it? St. Pat has a touchdown. Josh Kramer pounces on the fumble in the end zone, and St. Pat may have just iced the state championship. North Platte St. Pat's went on to beat Stanton 21-6, getting the Irish their first state football title since 1985. Will we have a new champion today, or will Cambridge get yet another trophy? We've got a long way to go before we find out the answer to those questions.
Dan Kieser's ball clubs over the years, he's been in the state finals eight times, has won six times, and trying to make it number seven here today. His final game, he's won 198 games, fellas, in his career at Cambridge.
Plainview Pirates getting set for their first offensive possession here at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln. No score. 11-13 remaining in this first quarter. Dan Kieser giving a look out there on the field. And let's look at the offense for the Plainview Pirates as they get set to start their offensive possession. The backs and receivers, Blake Mozell, David Aragi, Keelan Anderson, Brett Groff, Tom Johnson, Nicholas Yosten. Throughout the backs and receivers, the O-line, Luke Lingenfelter, Sean Meyer, Jace Kluber, Harrison Lingenfelter, and Chance Anderson on that offensive line for Plainview.
Still waiting here, Kevin, to get it underway. Waggy, we should add before we get started here, 1,330-some yards this year, almost 1,200 last year, just under 2,500 yards his last 2 years here for Plainview.
Ready to start from midfield, Plainview going to work on first down and 10 from the 50-yard line. Motion coming out of the backfield from Brett Raw. Give to the first man through. That's the fullback, Keelan Anderson. And Anderson takes it into Cambridge territory to the 47-yard line, a pickup of 3. Defensively for the Cambridge Trojans, very stingy defense throughout most of the year. Tony Hopkins, Bronson Susie, Jacob Langley, and Jared Sewell on that defensive line. The backs and linebackers, Brian Ballou, Mason Jackson, Lance Shiflett, Wade Vaunce, Anthony Lytle, Brett Crivelli, and Josh Keener, your backs and linebackers. Second down 7 from the 47-yard line. Rogge trying the middle of that Cambridge defensive line, picks up a couple, and it'll leave Plainview 5 yards shy of the first.
Plainview running, Damon, that Maryland eye. Why don't you talk about that Maryland eye?
Interesting, the Maryland eye, where it's one additional back in the backfield to dot the double eye. There's 3 backs back there. It should be an interesting matchup as you see Cambridge in a conventional 3-4 defense. How they handle that inside running game with those 3 linebackers.
I've always liked the Maryland eye for some reason. I'll tell you why after this play.
Mosel on the run. He's going to keep it, and Mosel gets a big hit, but he also ends up with a Plainview first down to the 38-yard line.
Well, Blake Mosel's a 3-year starter. He's going to fake the dive right here and just come with one protector out front and then turn it upfield. Got a good block right there. And picks up that first down. But I like the Maryland eye, Damon, because it gives the defense about 3 different looks. I mean, and you don't know really who's going to pick up that football in the back end there. And it's, yeah, you got 3, actually, you have 4 with the quarterback, as we just saw right there. I always like the Maryland eye.
Gives them a lot of versatility.
Yeah.
First down pass for Mosel. Throwing on the run. The catch is made at the 30-yard line, and down to the 27 goes Keelan Anderson. Another first down for Plainview as they move the ball down the field. And earlier we talked with head coach Joe Anderson of Plainview about his quarterback, Blake Mosel.
Blake's done a great job for this year. It's his 3rd year as a starter at quarterback, and he's really turned into a dual threat quarterback. He's been able to do it with his legs and his arm. He's completed 65% of his passes with only 5 interceptions and 15 touchdowns, which is a great percentage for a quarterback. And he's come up big in some of these playoff games with some big throws with his arms as well.
First down carry, gain of 3 to the 24-yard line. It'll be 2nd and 7 for Plainview as Rogge got his 2nd carry of the late morning here in Lincoln.
2 offensive philosophies couldn't be more different. A lot of beef up front for Plainview. They will grind you and wear you down and then try to hit you with play action. Cambridge a little more of the explosive of the two.
2nd down and 7. Toss play to the left side, trying to find some running room. Anderson pretty shifty on the cutback, and Anderson's in for the touchdown. Keelan Anderson takes it in, and Plainview out on top, 6-0.
You know, guys, I'm not sure if they read blitz or not, but they were blitzing from the right side that time. They ran the toss sweep to the left. Josh Keener, the corner, came up to help on the play, but just flat missed the tackle, and from that point on, it was Anderson all the way. But if they read that blitz and checked into the end of that play, great job by Mosel to do that.
Michael Stelling on to try the extra point. 36 of 42 on the year, and the extra point is no good. Missed it wide left, and the score will hang on at 6-0. Plainview with the lead. Let's watch the touchdown again from Keelan Anderson.
That's a good call by Adrian here early. Plainview did a good job of getting their athlete out in space. It was their man against Cambridge's defender, and he did a good job of reading the cutback lane and finding the end zone. That was an impressive move. It's tough to handle players out in space mano-a-mano like that. And good job of recognition by Plainview.
Open field tackles, Damon, you know the story there. It's extremely tough. Josh Keener, Jr., trying to catch up to Keelan Anderson, and he just gave him that left foot to the outside, cut it back, sharp cut to the inside, and then kind of weaved his way into the end zone from there to give his team a 6-point lead.
This December, see NET Television's production of At Close Range on assignment with National Geographic. NET followed Nebraskan and National Geographic photographer Joel Sartori as he traveled the world looking for the perfect shot. Sartori images are breathtaking in this high-definition production of At Close Range on assignment with National Geographic, December 4th at 7 Central Time, only on NET1.
Kevin, David, we also needed to mention that that's what the short field does for you, too. That's what starting your offense at the 50-yard line can do for you.
Line drive kick again, hops at the 15. Lytle advancing across the 25. And Lytle out near the 29-yard line, where Cambridge will start on their second offensive possession. Trying to get the ball moving, now down 6-0 here in this first quarter. We saw a real concerted effort, at least on that first drive. Cambridge trying to get the ball outside. We talked with Coach Kieser, running up the middle was one of the things he was concerned about with that big offensive, or rather defensive line of playing.
You know, with that, Damon, with that defense they're running, six down linemen, six people up front, two backers, man, there are some gaps that you could go to in the passing game.
First down and 10 from the 29. Straight ahead run this time by Shiflett. And Lance Shiflett moves it from the 29 out near the 33-yard line, a 4-yard pickup on first down.
It's a real tough read for Cambridge's offensive line, because although there are six people on the line of scrimmage, only four of them are in a four-point stance. So the tackles and tight ends have to do a good job of talking to one another, whether they treat those standing backers as down linemen. It's very important that they understand how to play that assignment football.
And all of that has to happen within a second or two.
Second down and 6 from the 33. Shiflett behind Vaughns. Shiflett gets the carry, and Shiflett across the 40-yard line with a first down. Earlier today, we talked with Dan Kieser and found out a little bit more about his head coach, Wade Vaughns.
Wade Vaughns is a multi-sport athlete that we're very fortunate to have. He has that extra sense, too, you know, that all winners have. But most of all, I'm pleased with him this year is his leadership. He's really stepped up the leadership for the team, and especially in the playoffs.
Vaughns is the guy that they rely on to make this offense go. First down and 10 from the 40, and Vaughns just takes the snap, goes straight ahead, and picks up 6 yards on the quarterback sneak. There's a great example of the kind of things Wade Vaughns does for you as an offense.
Yeah, he just recognized the split is what he did. He recognized the split of the defensive line and said, I got room to go here, and I'm going to take it and step right up right behind Jared Sewell, the offensive center. Picks up, what, about almost 6 yards? Well, yeah, 6 yards.
Caught Plainview covering up both of Cambridge's guards, which left that center with no one in front of him. And you take a look at the same setup again.
And Vaughns will keep it, this time over to the right side. A first down into Plainview territory. And Vaughns at the 45-yard line of Plainview with a first down, showing the experience of a third-year starter in Wade Vaughns.
You take a look at the right tackle. Does a heck of a job with a reach block. Good kickout block by the tailback. And then, again, as we talked about earlier, Vaughns, their best athlete, getting out in space, having a chance to make a play.
I'll tell you what I like about him, a two-time All-State football, basketball, but guys, he's also a two-time golf champion, and that's the part I like about it the best.
It's the part I'm most jealous of, I know that.
You and me both.
All three of us.
From the 45, Vaughns keeps, and Vaughns dives forward for 3 to the 42-yard line. It'll be 2nd and 7.
Guys, something to keep an eye on here early is Plainview's backers are flying to the edges. Puts a lot of pressure on Plainview's defensive tackles to hold up. Look for Cambridge to maybe be able to slip one here up the middle if Plainview stays with this same look.
They're relying on that strength and size up inside on their defensive line to allow those backers to do that. Here's a wide split of the defensive line again.
2nd down and 8. Wants to throw and threw it behind Anthony Lytle. Lytle coming in at about the first down marker, but Vaughns threw it on the outside and missed him. It's 3rd and 8.
And that's the kind of route, guys, that's going to be open pretty much all day if they stay in this very same defense, because you're running that 6-man front with 2 backers, 3 defensive people back there, and your inside seams in the secondary are going to be open a lot. So we'll see if they account for that or adjust for that. Now they're going to change it up a little bit on defense here. Goes some man over there on the far side.
3rd and 8. Here comes pressure. Vaughns gets a little time down the middle of the field. The catch is made, and down inside the 10-yard line goes Lance Shiflett. Terrific throw by Vaughns, right on the money to Lance Shiflett.
not only that, Kevin, he fit it right in between two defenders, too. Double coverage down there, and that's just an awesome, outstanding.
Two things that I like about this is we take a look at the replay. You look at Vance stand and deliver the ball under pressure, and then this, he threw it up the seam. He gave his guy the only chance to make the play. Heck of a throw under some serious duress by Vance.
19th catch of the season for Shiflett. And it's first and goal from the 7. Vance across the 5. Vance into the end zone. It's a touchdown. And Cambridge comes right back to tie Plainview at 6.
Trying to get it off to the edge right there. And an excellent block by Josh Keener. He took on the backer up over there. And just got in his way and said, hey, you can't make the tackle if you're not in position to make the tackle. And he didn't knock him down, but he just blocked his track. Josh Keener, the junior we talked about earlier at 5'9 and 148 pounds, taking on that big linebacker.
And here we see on the try for 2.
The conventional bone.
Going to the wishbone after a lot of spread and a lot of 3 and 4 wide. And up the middle it goes to Mason Jackson. And Jackson will not get the 2-point conversion. And so we will remain tied at 6 with 5:47 to play in the first quarter at Memorial Stadium. And we've got a good one going to the C2 title game.
Cambridge needed an answer, Damon, and they did. Making a football game out of it. Keep it under control. They're used to doing that. They have great diversity in their offense. We've seen that so far. But they also like to control up front.
Very good matchup that we have ensuing here with Lingenfelter. You take a look at the right tackle. Just doing an excellent job on the kickout block here. Oh, that was a look at the 2-point conversion. Here's the touchdown.
Here's the touchdown right here.
Good job by Coe. Working his way downfield. Vance in space has got to be a nightmare for those defenders. He's a big, strong kid who runs awfully well.
Get all the inside information on the Huskers after the Colorado game on Big Red Wrap-Up Tuesday, November 29th, live at 7 p.m. Central Time. It's a complete review with highlights, commentary, discussion, and the latest recruiting news with Huskers Illustrated's Sean Callahan. Join Adrian Fiala and me for our next Big Red Wrap-Up Tuesday, November 29th, right here on NET, Nebraska's home for sports.
Well, Cambridge was concerned about a fast start from Plainview, and they took care of business on offense on that last series and put it in the end zone, tied the ball game up, and started all over again here.
Pretty impressive drive for Cambridge right down the field. Big passing play helped out. And now time to kick it away. Short kick. Ball loose, and it's just going to be covered up at the 27-yard line. Pretty smart play not to try to make a play down there for Plainview. It was Grant Rutledge who just got on top of that ball and didn't risk a bobble or anything. It's not bad field position at the 27.
You know, guys, you take a look at the flags across the way, and the wind actually is blowing pretty well down there. Maybe Larry can give us an idea if it's straight away, gusting, swirling, whatever. But he threw that long pass, Kevin, you talked about, against a pretty stiff wind.
First down and 10 from the 27 back in the Maryland eye to start things off. And over the right side, David Aragi takes it from the 28-yard line and moves it forward near the 34. Good gain over that right side on first down.
As you take a look at the replay here with this Maryland eye, three linebackers, it puts stress on those three, especially your middle backer, because you have an additional blocker that's unaccounted for. If Cambridge wants to be able to deal with that Maryland eye later on in the game, they're going to have to eventually walk another safety up to deal with those guys at the line of scrimmage.
That and also slant. Run the slant and the defensive line. That last was just a straight shot forward. There's another good run by Rocky.
Yeah, a lot of room to run, and Rocky, a physical runner. You could hear the pads popping down there, and you could see Rocky does not shy away from contact. 5'11", 175 pounder.
It's just a simple numbers game right here. They've got 8 blockers that are dealing with 7. Cambridge is going to have to make an adjustment and get those safeties involved.
And plus, David, you look at the size. They like to run over there on the right side behind Harrison Lingenfelter and Anderson, and Chase Kluver, the center, at 225 over that right end.
First down and 10 from the 42. Tied at 6. And working up the middle, Keelan Anderson shows extreme elusiveness when he gets out there. kind of stepping and tiptoeing his way around tacklers, and another good run from that fullback position for Keelan Anderson.
Watch on the replay here. Well, we won't be able to see it, actually, but that was just a great example of how deceptive the Maryland eye can be, because all three backs on that play exploded. Everybody went a different direction. So if you're keying back there as a linebacker, you talked about, Damon, that really puts you in a bad state of affairs, man.
First down, Rogge gets the carry this time, working over that left side, and a 2-yard pickup this time. Plain Cambridge rather in there to get the stop. Mason Jackson also helping out on that play. Bronson Susie as well.
And kind of a misconception about the Maryland eye is that it's too slow developing, but when you're able to run the Maryland eye, you're awful good up front, because they are controlling the line of scrimmage, giving those tailbacks a chance to do what they do with the play action fakes.
Second down, 8 from the 42. Rogge again with a big hole to run through up the middle. Rogge to the 33-yard line, a 9-yard pickup, and another first down for Plainview.
Guess where this one goes, guys? Right between Kluver and Lingenfelder, leading up the two backs, leading up inside. Man, that's a tough one to stop. Extremely tough to stop.
Coach Kieser talked about it. He was worried about being able to stop that power run game in between the tackles.
Joe Anderson likes this sort of offense. Like you said, nothing fancy. We're just going to come at you and smack you around a little bit. They're getting it done.
First down, 10 from the 33. Rogge gets the carry. Good job that time by Cambridge to stuff the run. And Brett Crabelli, that strong safety, came up to help out. Earlier we talked with Dan Kieser, and we asked him, what you worried about, Coach, about this Plainview Pirate team?
Running between the tackles. They got great size and just run the ball right at us and attacking us in that way. And in some way to find a way for us to get a running game going against their defense. Their defensive front, that 6 front, and those 2 linebackers are good. And so somehow we got to find a way to get the ball on the ground.
Second down, 8, and trying to bounce it to the outside. Rogge with room to roam before Crabelli brings him down at the 22. Another first down. And another 9-yard pickup for Plainview on the ground.
Plainview just using that power, using that deception, using that speed to get it to the edge here. Good pursuit here. Crabelli coming up from his safety spot, Damon, to help support, but man, they picked up way too much yardage on the play.
Well, you hit the nail on the head earlier when you talked about the deception. Crabelli was unblocked, but he froze, honoring the fake inside, and it didn't allow him to get out on the perimeter until after an 8-9-yard gain.
Timeout taken by Cambridge, a chance to perhaps regroup a little bit, as Plainview doing exactly what they want to do, guys. They are just moving it up and down the field. Well, tonight we've got another good one for you in the Class A State Championship, 7 o'clock Central Time. Be sure you're with us for a great matchup. Lincoln Southwest in its first ever title game, going up against the Millard North Mustangs, veterans in the Class A Championship. Should be a great matchup. Lincoln Southwest, Millard North tonight at 7 o'clock Central Time on NET1 and NET HD. Looking forward to that.
Should be a heck of a game tonight, guys. We're looking, Damon, you followed Millard North pretty closely, and I've kept my eye on Lincoln Southwest, so really anxious to see those two teams really go at it tonight.
Let's go downstairs, check in with Larry.
Kevin, okay, Adrian asked about the wind, and this is one of those rare times at Memorial Stadium where it's coming out of the direction exactly what the flag shows. It's blowing strong toward the north here down on the field, and so that throw that Vaunce made was directly into the wind.
Well, that makes it even more impressive.
Absolutely.
Thinking about that wind. And that is, Larry's right, it's one of the rare times where you can judge the field wind by the flag. That doesn't happen that often.
Most of the time in this stadium, and Damon, you've played here recently, it swirls around quite a bit. When you have strong winds, it swirls around, but that's what I was concerned, or just really interested to see how that wind was going with that long throw we saw. Here we go.
Second down and 6. Rogge gets the carry again. Rogge across the 5-yard line and down to the 4. Another big burst, 13-yard run.
Either you're awful bright or we're awful slow. Kluver, Langenfelter again. You know, we talk about the epitome of insanity being doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. Cambridge has got to account for the spare blocker in the hole.
Look at the block right there by Lingenfelter. I mean, that's just incredible what he's doing. And then you got two people leading it up. Here it goes again, and same deal.
And Rogge, same results. Is he down at the 1? Looks like he is down at the 1-yard line. And it'll be second and goal from there. But Plainview just doing exactly what they want to do, eating up yardage and eating up time This is a vintage Plainview drive.
You know, David, there's nothing in the rocket as far as the science goes to what you're going to do when you've got a guy like Harrison Lingenfelder at 6'4", 265. I mean, I'm going behind him all the time. And as a running back, former running back, you like that kind of guy.
Absolutely.
Second down goal from the one. Roggy, touchdown, Plainview.
See, you know, that play there, you've got to commit. I mean, you've only got one shot to make a play, and you got three people in the backfield, and who do you pick? Do you pick the first guy, the second guy, or is it the third guy? In this case, it's the third guy of the ball, but you don't know that before the play goes.
Again, just a simple numbers game. I mean, you're looking at eight taking care of seven. Cambridge is going to have to adjust to the front that they're seeing.
Michael Stelling on for the extra point. And it's a fake. Stelling's going to try to throw into the end zone. The leaping grab is there, and the two is good. Keelan Anderson makes the catch on the fake. And Plainview leads 14-6.
Good reaction by Cambridge to get to the play, but Plainview does even better. They fight for the ball and make it work for two.
Well executed.
Well, let's watch the fake.
Get here.
It's a fake all the way here. Good throw by the kicker, too. Tough to do that with that big neck roll he's got. that was on the numbers.
Yeah, most kickers aren't really prone to throwing the football very well.
Nor do you want most kickers throwing the football.
Just kick the ball. That's all you want to do.
In high school, you got to do a little bit of everything. Be a jack of all trades at the high school level. So Plainview answers the Cambridge scoring drive, and we'll see what Cambridge is able to do. This is shaping up to be maybe one of those games where the team that has the ball last gets the win.
Could very well be. You know, Cambridge running that wishbone reminiscent of Oklahoma, a lot of those Nebraska-Oklahoma games years ago. That's what it boiled down to, who gets the pick last.
Well, Cambridge trying to send Dan Keyser out a winner, and Plainview trying to claim a championship for the first time since 1975. So a lot at stake for both of these teams, and another low line drive kick, and it bounces right into the hands of Vaunce. Vaunce out to the 30-yard line, and Cambridge will start there, first down and 10. And look at this Plainview team, and they are a fired up bunch right now.
I was just going to talk about that. You talked earlier about a team taking on the persona of their coach, and Cambridge very low key, like Coach Keyser, unassuming. Plainview, just the opposite, have been jumping around, high-fiving, very emotional since pregame.
You bet. They're fired, and you know, when you have a little early success like they've had here, it fires you up even more.
First down and 10 from the 30. Vaunce floats it out. Nice grab at the 45-yard line, and into Plainview territory goes the tight end, Jacob Benson. And a first down for Cambridge and a pickup of 22 yards.
Linebacker trying to keep up there, Damon. Nicholas Yostin, 44.
Yeah, Cambridge is definitely onto something.
Beat him out of it. There's that seam we talked about. It's going to be open until they adjust. It's going to be open.
Adrian, that time nobody went with the tailback. Plainview's got to make their mind up here. They're either going to get stretched vertically or horizontally.
This offense really puts pressure on the D.
Vaunce running the option, but he and Shiflett looked like Siamese twins running down the line there, and then he fell down at the line of scrimmage.
You talk about that one, because that was clearly a quarterback situation there.
Well, I tell you, it looked like they went back a little old school here with the little belly give, and he's reading, and up. I changed my mind as Keenan closed down there on the end. He decided to keep the football. Looks like the give was there in that little belly option.
Yeah, when that quarterback keeps his hand in there as the option man there, the belly man, you know something's going to happen.
Second down 10 from the 49 of Plainview. 14-6 Plainview leading. And this time nothing up the middle there. And the question that's coming out of Lance Shiflett's mouth is, you should have kept it that time. Sean Meyer sandwiched him right at the line of scrimmage. It's third and 10.
Meyer just popped him like he was going right through the door. Wow, what a hit that was. Sean Meyer, 6'1", 265 pounds. He's a junior. He'll be back to menace people again next year.
Third down and 10 for Cambridge from the Plainview 49. Motion Shiflett out of the backfield. Down the sideline looking for Lytle, and it's incomplete. Anthony Lytle well covered out there for Plainview by Phillip Hamilton.
You know, guys, on the motion, the safety on the far side went with the motion, and it opened up that area wide open. I'm surprised we won't see it here, but you sneak somebody into that area because, see, there's nobody there. See,
absolutely,
nobody in that area right there. And I think Cambridge will pick up on that, and eventually you will see somebody in that area.
In the very bottom of the screen, you saw number 22, who was wide open for Cambridge on that right hash. I believe that was Shiflett, who had a chance at a big play if Vance would have looked back to his backside.
Here comes the punt. Phillip Hamilton takes it at the 10-yard line. Hamilton to the 15. Hamilton working out to the 20-yard line. And that's where Plainview will start, first down and 10, leading 14-6. And the first quarter of this C2 state championship game has come to a close. So through one quarter, some very exciting play. Good one in C2 as Plainview leads Cambridge after one, 14-6. Start of the second quarter in the C2 championship game, along with Adrian Fiala, Damon Benning, Larry Putney. I'm Kevin Kugler. Great day for football in Lincoln. Great day to bring you a state championship game or two, and that's what we'll do here today at NET Sports. We've got C2 today, and then tonight we have the Class A game. Plainview leading to start this second quarter, first down and 10 from the 20-yard line. And right up the middle, nothing doing as Rogge may have picked up a yard, and that's all. Cambridge pretty good defensively on that first down carry.
Terrific fill that time. Looked like number 22, Lance Shiflett, up inside there, along with Bronson Soucy, to stuff that play, David.
Coach Keyser already made the first chess move. He's actually in a 4-4 now. You see the safety walk up, three DBs. Mm-hmm. A 44 look now from Cambridge. That's the first adjustment made in this game so far.
Second down, 9. Mosel on the run. Pressure coming up, and down he goes. There was pressure in front and then pressure from behind that finally brought him down, as he was chased down from behind on the play by Jacob Benson.
Good boot action here.
Yeah, looking for Yostin over the middle. Yostin was open early. He was open right about now, but Mosel could not pick him up. And by that time, it was too late. Pursuit catches after about maybe a 2-yard gain.
Third down, a long 7 for Plainview. Two wide left of the line on this third down and 7. Mosel on the roll, a lot of black jerseys in front of him, and he throws that straight out of bounds and into the third row here at Memorial Stadium. Cambridge had pressure all around, and Mosel had nowhere to go.
Brian Ballou on the pressure. He actually got the hit on Mosel. There were 3 or 4 people after Mosel. See it right here. And there's the hit we talked about. Unfortunately, just gets rid of the football, doesn't take that sack, but it's going to be a punt.
Tremendous job of adjusting by Cambridge. They did just what
played
we
well.
Talked about earlier. Walked that safety up. Now they're in a true 44 look. Plainview might have to throw the ball here a little bit.
Brett Crabelli and Anthony Lytle back to return this punt. Crabelli bobbles the football at midfield. Plainview says they have it. They'll unstack the pile before the official word comes, and it is Plainview football.
Looked like number 21 came out of there. Keelan Anderson with the football, guys. Very alert, great coverage.
Classic case here of trying to make a move before you've secured the football.
He's got protection to make the catch, even if he bobbles it on the catch, but he caught the ball and then made a step or two, and that takes that protection away. And boy, Plainview gets a big break right here.
First down and 10 from midfield for Plainview. Rogge on the toss sweep, gets to the outside. Rogge lowering that shoulder pad as he drives out of bounds. 9.5-yard pickup is about a half yard shy of a first down.
Getting their athletes out here in space. Cambridge was actually in position to make a play, but
look at the block in there, man.
Rogge just makes a move here. Oh, a little bit of some sort of a clip there that they missed there, and Rogge takes advantage of it and moved to a 9-10-yard run.
Second and very short. Mosel under center. Backs in the Maryland eye. First back through Keelan Anderson. And he's down to the 34-yard line of Cambridge. Let's go downstairs to Larry.
Well, thanks, Kevin. I'm here with Bob Lingenfelter. Many of you remember Bobby played football at Nebraska 74, 75, 76. And the father of Harrison, boy, he's just dominating up front right now.
Well, he's had a pretty good year. He popped a knee there in basketball and come down here. Doc Clare put it back together, and I think he got it better than he had it originally. He's had a good year. He's worked hard, good work ethic. That whole team has been that way.
And Luke is your nephew. He's in there, too. That makes a couple of pretty big Lingenfelters in there.
Well, they kind of the bookends. They're both playing defensive ends. They both come in and played some defensive tackle, too, and they've worked at guard, and they've had a lot of fun. You like to see team sports, and this group has been a real team-orientated group.
What's Harrison going to do next year? Does he know?
Boy, Nebraska doesn't seem to show any interest in him, but Iowa State, Barney Cotton over there has talked to him. Kansas State, Kansas, Colorado State, so I'm not sure.
Still up in the air.
I would still like to have him come down here and play. It looks to me like, the tackle spot down here would be still open.
All right, thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
Bob Lingenfelter, a Husker from 74 to 76, an All Big Eight in 1976, All Big Eight offensive tackle.
Pretty
some
straight shooter there.
Yeah,
you're not leaving that interview wondering what Bob was thinking, were you?
First down and 10 from the 20. Rogge gets the carry again and is able to just push forward for a nearly 5-yard gain. I got the sense, and he was a little subtle. I got the sense that he'd like Nebraska to take another look at Harrison. Maybe I'm reading too much into that conversation.
Somebody will get a tape of this game, I'm sure.
Think he's enamored with Nebraska's tackle play at this particular juncture.
Second down and 6 from the 16. Plainview leading 14-6 and trying to take advantage of the muffed punt and move it in for another score. Mosel again lined up in that Maryland eye. The backs behind Mosel as Keelan Anderson just tries to pick his way forward. Ends up near the 13-yard line. That'll leave him 3 yards shy of a Plainview first down. 8:25 remaining in this first half. 14-6 Plainview leading. Right now Plainview doing what they want to do. 150 yards on the ground for Plainview.
In a game of attrition, this just has to be a grind right now early in this game for Cambridge.
And movement up front. Perhaps Mosel changing the cadence a little bit, but looked like Tony Hopkins may have come out of his stance and likely cost the Cambridge Trojans, and it will, 5 yards, and it'll give Plainview a first down.
Contrary to college, people watching today, contrary to college, a lineman can do that and get back. In high school, when you encroach in the zone, it's called right away. So that's why the whistle blew and the flag was thrown.
First and goal now for Plainview from the 8-yard line, leading 14-6. Mosel with Keelan Anderson on the carry and nothing doing that time. Bronson Soucy right on top of Anderson. Wouldn't let him go. He lost a yard back to the 9.
Soucy on the year, 62 tackles coming in to today, and he's been one of the leaders, guys, of this defense. And Dan Keyser really talks well about Soucy and Anthony Hopkins, an All-State player, as being the physical and emotional leaders of the team.
Second down, Rogge with blocking out in front. Rogge across the 5 and down to the 3-yard line. 6-yard pickup, third and goal for Plainview.
It's like a convoy going on over there.
You take a look at the replay, he made this a little tougher than it had to be. If he bounces a little bit to his left, he can probably walk in. Tremendous job pulling by the guard and the tackle here.
Problem he had right there is if the blocker could step up just a little bit quicker, Damon, that play maybe goes in. But again, a convoy of blockers on the play. Third down attempt here, 3rd and 3.
The give to Rogge one more time, and a great tackle made in the backfield by Wade Vaughns. Threw him back down at the 6-yard line, and that's a huge play for the Cambridge defense.
But Damon, you talked about his athletic ability. There it is.
Absolutely. Wow. He needed to make a stop here on defense. And And he's their best player on offense. He just might be their best player on defense as we see him shoot the gap. And not only did he shoot the gap, Adrian, he made the play when he had a chance to make the play. You can't put a premium on pulling that off.
And when you're down there, as we said earlier, you only got one shot to do it.
Fourth and goal from the six. Mosel to throw. Now Mosel to run. Can he get in? No, he cannot. The ball pops out, but either way, it's going to belong to Cambridge. And a big shot in the arm for the Cambridge Trojans. First and goal from the eight, and they turn Plainview away without any points.
What looks like a sure touchdown here, guys, is eliminated by Brett Cabelli. Watch this here as Mosel looking good right now.
Great lots closing great. Speed.
Watch Cabelli come out. I guess we should give a lot of credit also to Brian Ballou on that first hit. If he doesn't make that, he's probably going.
Write that one down. I think if I'm Coach Anderson, I've got to take the 3 points. You got a veteran ball club like Cambridge. You don't want to keep them hanging around. I'd have got the points there.
First down and 10 from the four. Up the middle, Shiflett. And Shiflett gets some running room out to the 11-yard line.
Talked earlier, you put some serious stress on your tackles in this formation that they're going to hold up their end of the deal. Talked earlier about Cambridge maybe being able to slip one inside here. You almost saw it there. I still think it's coming before the game wears on. Right up the middle. Quick hitter.
Second down and three from the 11. 5:40 remaining in this first half. Shiflett again gets the carry and not as much room up the middle, but he's still able to slip through and get near a first down. Well, earlier today we talked with the head coach of Plainview, Joe Anderson, about his concerns with the Cambridge Trojans.
Obviously, look at Cambridge. You know, they've been here a lot of years, and you look at film, you see their quarterback. You know, the kid's a three-year, probably all-state quarterback, and he can do it again, beat you with his arm and beat you with his legs. And we got to be able to contain him, get some pressure on him.
Third down and inches. Vaunts will move it ahead across the 15 to the 16. That'll be a first down for Cambridge as Vaunts is easily able to acquire that short yardage and get another first down for Cambridge.
Well, they started at the 3. They're out right about the 16. So they've just been able to grind it. Damon, as you said a moment ago, just grind it. That one play about two steps away from really getting out to about midfield.
Right.
Plainview's got such excellent linebacking, though. People can run folks down.
First down from the 16. Vaughn set to throw. And in and out of the hands of Lance Shiflett, who was a little bit behind Shiflett. Shiflett had to try to come back and make that catch, but it's second down and 10.
It's about the third or fourth ball now that has touched a receiver's hands, but hasn't been completed. Coming on the blitz, you just saw that arm wave. I think that was Lingenfelder. That arm wave just about knocked the ball away. It's a little bit late.
I'd like to see Vaughn step and deliver that football with his work on his footwork there a little bit. That's probably a completion. You know, the age-old adage, he stepped away from this target, and that's where the ball went. It sailed on him a little bit. Good athlete, though, back there taking snaps.
Well, with this timeout, it's time to test your Nebraska high school football knowledge with today's trivia question, sponsored by Nebraska Public Power District, always there when you need us. In 11-man regular season play, which player had the longest interception return for a touchdown in Nebraska high school history? Email your answer to sports@netnebraska.org. The first correct answer wins a cool athletic gray NET Sports t-shirt, size extra large, along with a black ceramic NET Sports beverage mug. Show us your high school football knowledge. Send an email to sports@netnebraska.org. The winner will be announced later in the game.
Longest PI, huh?
Yeah, I got four people. It was Adrian.
Yeah.
It
yeah, was. Right. I couldn't drive my car that far.
It was, and it wasn't me either. And it wasn't Damon. It's no one in this booth. There's your hint for the day.
Already probably a win for Cambridge, getting a first down, giving that defense any sort of chance to rest here.
See if they can pick up some more yardage on second down with Vaughn getting to the outside and just tripped up at the 22-yard line. Picks up 6 yards on second and 10, and that'll bring up a third and 4 for Cambridge. And we're at Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska, along with Adrian Fiala, Damon Benning, Larry Putney rolling the sidelines. I'm Kevin Kugler. Terrific to have you with us on this C2 title game today. You're on NET Sports tonight at 7. It's the Class A game. Then tomorrow, C1 and B. As we continue complete coverage of the Nebraska State High School Football Championships. Third and four from the 22-yard line. Vaunce in the shotgun. Pressure coming. Vaunce in trouble, and down he goes. Back at the 9-yard line. They brought pressure with David Rogge. Rogge got there for the sack.
Rogge just picked up his fifth sack of the season right there, guys. And spread formation that time, David, and everybody locked down man-to-man, and they came with the blitz, and it worked.
Vaunce didn't help himself out. He actually rolled to the blitz side. If he had that to do over again, I'm sure he might have maybe stayed in the pocket. He had some good protection to his left. He kind of panicked a little bit back there in the pocket and rolled towards the blitz.
Punt time. As Vaunce stands 3 yards deep in the end zone to punt it away. It's a short line drive kick. Takes a good Cambridge roll. In fact, it rolls right past the intended returner, Philip Hamilton, who picks it up, and that is dropped all the way back at the 20-yard line. Talk about flipping the field. That punt just did it for Cambridge.
40 yards on the roll and trying to come up with that ball. You're waiting for the clubhouse bounce. On the, well, Damon, you know about clubhouse bounces. You picked it up at the 2-yard line, ran it all the way back for 98 yards. But, again, that ball, a lot of times you wait for that clubhouse bounce. It doesn't come. Didn't come there. And it cost him 40 yards on the return here. Wow.
If you'd like to get yourself a VHS or DVD copy of today's playoff game or any playoff game, log on to netnebraska.org or make it very simple. And we'll give you the phone number to call in just a moment. Is out to the outside, works Keelan Anderson. And Anderson picks up good yardage on first down, second and four. There's the phone number, 1-800-228-4630, the number to call as well. You just click on the sports link if you log on to netnebraska.org. We'd love to get you a DVD of this game or any of our state high school football or volleyball championships. It's a memory that's certain to last for years to come. NET, Nebraska's home for sports.
That was a 64-yard punt by Vaunce, about 40 of it on the roll.
Straight ahead carry again for Rogge, and Rogge a yard short of the first down, brought down by Tony Hopkins for Cambridge.
I tell you, Rogge gets a lot of the hype, but I tell you, a player that I'm impressed with thus far is Keelan Anderson. He's done a little bit of everything for this ball club. He's not only been a good lead blocker, he's carried the ball, he caught a two-point conversion. He's been all over the field for Plainview.
Very elusive, too. I've enjoyed watching him.
Tremendous vision, very good vision.
Excellent on defense, also.
Third down and one from the 30. As we speak of him, Keelan Anderson gets the carry and is stacked up very close to the first down. Yeah, I think you're right, David. I think it's going to be just a shade short as they unstack it. And our officiating crew will give it a look. Looks like he needed to get it right up to the 31-yard line, and it is not at the 31-yard line. They'll bring in the chains, and we'll see for sure.
Eagle eye in the sky, Adrian. You care to take a stab at this?
Well,
one?
He had to get it right to the hash mark there, right to the nose of the hash mark. And without the benefit of the binoculars, Damon, I'm going to say he got it.
I'll go with just short.
Oh, my. It's right on the nose, and it's a first down.
And I didn't look at the binoculars either.
Adrian Fiala.
They had to give it a double take.
It passed the smell test up here, I want to tell you.
And I mean, you said it'd be right on there, and you were right. It couldn't have been more
well,
on it.
The nose had to get to see you look at that marker on the far sideline, and they had the marker right at the edge of the hash mark, and that ball was very, very close to that. So, hey, give it a go.
We did call him Eagle Eyes.
First down and 10 from the 31. Who knew he had it in him? On the toss play, Rogge, flags are down, and Rogge dropped at the 33-yard line, but this is likely going to cost Plainview 10 yards thrown in the direction of a hole.
You'll want the name of my optometrist, I'll tell you after the game, guys.
Tell you what, I'm impressed. I mean, that's no one. That's why he's the color voice of the Huskers.
That was
right there.
That was a big play because a big first down, because otherwise they have to punt it away and give Cambridge another opportunity here with a little over 2 minutes left in the ball game. But now if they can control it here, see what this penalty is. Plainview backing up.
No official word yet. They're discussing it with.
You take the Cambridge. 10 or do you go second and 9? I think you take the 10.
Let's see what.
Here I am thinking that I know what the call is. It looked like Susie got spun around.
It is a hold, and they will take the 10. Benning, very presumptuous, but he is right in this instance. And it's back to the 20-yard line where it'll be first down and 21 yards, actually. They need the 41 for a first. First and 21 back at the 20-yard line. Plainview will line up again in that Maryland eye. Now motion out of the eye. And straight ahead give to Keelan Anderson, and Keelan Anderson corralled by a host of Trojans. Line didn't get much push on the offensive side that time, and Cambridge able to bury Keelan Anderson. No gain on the play.
Anthony Hopkins really instrumental there, Kevin. He just stacked up the trap block and backed the blocker right back into the ball carrier that time. Number 73 for Cambridge. Big guy at 6'5", 222, but what a whale of a job he did on that play. They were trying to trap him with the block, and it just did not work. And he was able to make the play.
Second down 20 from the 21. Time winding down in this first half. Trying that left side. Plainview just content to head into the locker room, but a timeout is going to be used by Cambridge here. They've got the wind at their back, and they're more than willing to allow Plainview to run one more play and perhaps get it back with that passing game, have a shot to get on the board before the end of the first half.
They've got the offense that's built to do it. If they can maybe get the ball back here somewhere around the 50-yard line, I take my chances with Wade Vaughns. They've shown, Adrian alluded to it earlier, if they hang on to a couple of these earlier passes, we could be looking at a different game here. But, you know, Coach Kieser wants to take his chances with getting the ball back here. They can get a stop here on third down.
And David, if he can get outside, he can hurt you with a throw, as you say. Hurt you quite well, but he can also hurt you with the legs. He's just a dual threat quarterback that can really do a number of things to hurt you offensively. Very quickly, guys, David Rogge, that last carry just put him right at 100 yards. 18 carries on the day for 100 yards and a touchdown.
Pretty impressive first half for the junior running back for Plainview. Now 1,432 yards rushing on the season.
Extremely impressed with Plainview's offensive line. I'm looking at Langenfelter and Kluver, and these guys come off the ball. It's a beautiful thing to watch. These guys are firing off the football.
Third down 19, the ball at the 22-yard line. Plainview with four wide receivers into the pattern. Mosel will just keep and run, and Mosel's going to be dropped for a loss on the play. And another good surge into the backfield by Bronson Soucy, who was the first guy to get to Mosel.
We take a look. Plainview went to a four wide set, so gave Cambridge a chance to get back into their conventional 3-4, which they played extremely well. In a game of adjustments right now, you got to give Cambridge some credit for hanging in there.
They've done an excellent job of that, Damon. That last play just a little bit strange in my book, but hey, we'll see the punt now. I'm not sure what, you know, it looked like pass. So you saw Linkenfelder setting up for pass, but then you saw Mosel just kind of tuck it and go right away. So
Plainview had some personnel issues, guys, and they were forced to use a timeout and stop the clock. Cambridge is out of timeouts. They had to use one to stop the clock, and Cambridge is going to get the ball back with probably about 27, 26 seconds in this half to try to do something.
Yeah, depending on the length of the run, if there is a return, Kevin, that, you know, they might burn more than that on this play. We'll see.
Interesting. Coach Kieser, I just noticed, changed a little bit of his personnel. I don't think they would attempt a block here, but they very well could.
Let's watch. Let's see what the alignment is on defense. Be able to tell a little bit from that.
Coming December 4th to NET1, Great Performances looks back to the golden age of television with the 1965 special, My Name is Barbara. The black and white telecast introducing the arrival of Barbara Streisand. Digitally remastered and restored, the 40th anniversary telecast finds the singer-actress just 23 years old. Don't miss Barbara Streisand in Great Performances, My Name is Barbara, Sunday night, December 4th at 8:30 Central Time, only on NET1.
Got everybody up.
Fourth down and 23 from the 18. Taken at the 49 and down. Second time today that Brett Crivelli's had a little problem fielding that punt, but great field position for Cambridge. 29 seconds left in the half, and they're on the Plainview side of midfield.
Got the win at their back. You'd think they'd need to get at least 25 yards for a legitimate shot at a field goal attempt here. That put him right at about a 42, 43 yarder. Well, a couple of weeks ago, I did see 106 yards in field goals. 54-yarder and a 52-yarder.
Swing out on the sideline and thrown down is Crabelli at the 44-45-yard line. Coming up at halftime, we'll check in on how the cross-country finals went and bring you your first half highlights and stats. That's coming up at halftime. Second down and six from the 45. Three wide left of the line. Fake by Vaunce. Now throwing down the left side. Josh Keener is out there and just off the fingertips. Just a little bit long for Keener. He was open and had a chance to pull one in for six.
Boy, that pump fake. David set that baby up in good shape. He pumped a fake over here down below us, right to the left of the formation, and then fired away, and it was waiting for Crabelli to try to or check it. Who was the deep man that time? Keener was the intended receiver deep. And
well conceived. They faked the slip screen, and the blocker faked like he was going to block and right up the hash. And he had him. Tough to run fast with your hands out, though.
Keener in motion towards the slot. It's third and six from the 45. Vaunce rolling to the right, looking for someone open. Throws across his body, and that pass is almost intercepted at the six-yard line. Intended out there for Anthony Lytle, and good coverage downfield by Plainview. Vaunce didn't have a lot of options there.
Brett Groff on the coverage. He has intercepted four this year. As you watch Vaunce, plenty of time to throw. Pressure coming. He lets it fly, but underthrows it. And there you see Groff in and out of the hands. You got to catch the ball in the hands. Don't use that body.
Fourth down and six from the 45-yard line. 6 seconds left in the half. Vaunce, straight drop. Throws a wobbler out there as he got clocked, and the pass falls incomplete. Vaunce got drilled as he threw it by Harrison Lingenfelter. Vaunce, I mean, he took a shot as he threw that ball. And we're going to get a chance to look at what might be the biggest hit of the state tournament.
Oh, my. Watch this one. Lingenfelter at 265. Vaunce looking. Now watch this. Oh, my. That hurt even looking at it.
Those are the kisses you don't like to receive right there.
And you can see Vaunce didn't like to receive it either. He is a little bit wobbly right now after taking that pop from Harrison Lingenfelter. And that's a key to the second half. They need to get him healthy in time for the second half. Let's go downstairs to Larry Putnam.
Well, Dan, they had 164 yards rushing, but you were able to make enough adjustments to keep him out of the end zone, especially late.
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah, but they're controlling the line of scrimmage on us right now, and somehow we got to get the line of scrimmage back.
Now, offensively, you're finding ways to move the ball, just not in the end zone.
Right, and we dropped some passes, too. We could have moved it more effectively, so we've got to catch the ball, and, you know, that turnover on the punt return was costly also.
Thanks, Dan.
All right.
Dan Keyser, the head coach of Cambridge. His Trojans trail at halftime in Lincoln to the Plainview Pirates. It's 14-6. Plainview with the lead over Cambridge. Halftime is here in the C2 title game. We'll have more from Memorial Stadium in a moment. The scenes of fall in Nebraska. And fall in Nebraska means state high school football championships. We've got a good one going in C2 with Plainview leading Cambridge 14-6. At halftime. Welcome back to Memorial Stadium in Lincoln, Nebraska, where halftime festivities are going on Tom Osborne Field and also here in the booth. I'm joined by Larry Mohring, assistant director of the NSAA, and we've talked about this, Larry. Great chance not only to talk football, but to talk about a variety of other sports going on throughout the fall. Cross country recently finished in another terrific cross country tournament that was well competed. And to tell us a little bit about what happened this year cross country.
Well, first of all, we had a great day weather-wise, which is always a concern at state cross country.
Very good job on your part. I assume you take full credit for that.
No, that goes to Bob Colgate and Jennifer Schwartz. They're in charge of weather good. On those days. So, no, it was an excellent day. We hold that in Kearney. Kearney Country Club is very hospitable to us and has done a great job getting the course prepared. UNK with Rich Broderson and Andy Meyer take credit, most of the credit, and it's where it's due because they do an excellent job running that cross-country meet.
What does it take to get a course ready and get a cross-country meet ready for the amount of runners that you have? And I mean, we're looking at some footage now, and it's obvious that there's a lot of folks running cross-country in the state of Nebraska these days.
There's a lot, and we're actually seeing an increase in the numbers. We're even looking at our smallest class, adding another district because of the numbers have increased. Full teams are more the norm than it used to be. We used to have individuals from schools, but now they all seem to be fielding full teams, and it's taken off. Getting a course ready, Kearney basically has to get rid of the golfers. They have to tell them they can't golf anymore, and that's a challenge at a private course. So, but we do appreciate what they've done, and they take a lot of pride in operating and running that meet.
Well, why do you suppose we've seen such an increase in numbers in cross country over the years? And you're right, the numbers have gone up steadily, it seems, every single year in cross country.
You know, I'm not sure. I know that we've seen an emphasis on it at the coaches' clinic. The clinicians have come in. They've had some excellent coaching. And that kind of perpetuates the entire situation. When you have good athletes and coaches that know what they're doing, and I think our state takes a lot of pride in that.
Well, one of the things you see when you see a sport grow like cross country is growing in the state of Nebraska, you see better competition. As everybody starts to compete, you see better competitors, a little more pressure on those competitors to improve their times. It makes for a much more exciting sport.
You're absolutely right. It's similar to other sports. Volleyball in particular in the state of Nebraska is huge. We see a lot of Division I athletes, and we're seeing the same thing in runners. A lot of our athletes are taking scholarships at maybe smaller colleges or D1 universities, and that's it increases the interest in we see a lot more runners then.
Well, a lot of champions were crowned in the state cross-country tournament. Let's take a look first at the boys' champions. Fremont always has great runners. Scotts Bluff, Syracuse, Malcolm, your four boys' champions this year.
I think we had a very close race in Class B. Well, Scotts Bluff always has great runners. Out west, they have some great tradition, and I think we saw several runners in the top 10 from the out west in the Western
District. A lot
of
great places to run out in Scotts Bluff area.
A lot of room to run. Absolutely. I've been out there several times and love that place. So.
Well, let's take a look at the girls' champions then in the state cross-country meet. Omaha Marion every year. Omaha Marion right there in the thick of things. Lincoln Pius the 10th, Wahoo Bishop Newman, and East Butler, your girls' state cross-country champions this year.
Right. Pius, I think, is defending champion, and they defended it again this year. They have some excellent runners. I know George O'Boyle at Pius does an excellent job with the cross-country program.
Well, and you've seen this too, and I'm sure you hear this from a lot of your athletes and a lot of your coaches. Cross-country is such a great way to keep in shape for kids who are doing other sports throughout the winter and throughout the spring. Then cross-country, one of those great things for basketball coaches to have their kids go out and play if they're not playing football or other sports.
Plus, it's also a lifetime skill. It's something that, and if you're in any community, you're going to see runners all during the day. I noticed moving to Lincoln a couple years ago, my neighborhood's full of runners, and a lot of them have been cross-country participants. So it's a great lifetime skill, and we're just real pleased with the results of cross-country.
Well, Larry, thanks so much for stopping by. We sure appreciate it. Thanks for filling us in on cross-country.
And thank you.
Larry Mulring, assistant director of the NSAA. We are at halftime, where Plainview leads Cambridge 14-6. If you've missed any of the action, the first half highlights are next.
You're watching NET Television, Nebraska's PBS station.
NET Sports coverage of the 2005 Nebraska State High School Football Championships are brought to you in part by the Nebraska Public Power District, always there when you need us. By Education Quest Foundation, improving access to college through scholarships, community grants, and college planning services. And by the Nebraska Soybean Board, promoting soy biodiesel fuel, clean burning and renewable, making a difference for soybean farmers and you. Vine Street in Lincoln, it's at the lunch hour. Everybody's out trying to get themselves something to eat. Here at halftime, Plainview eating up a lot of yardage on the ground, 14-6 the lead over Cambridge here at halftime, along with Adrian Fiala, Damon Benning, and Larry Putney. I'm Kevin Kugler. In this C2 championship game, Plainview leading Cambridge 14-6. And how did it happen, you ask? Well, let's take a look at the highlights from this first half. And we saw a lot of this, a lot of running from Plainview.
Plainview picked up 115 yards in the first half, Kevin.
We saw this touchdown run by Kalen Anderson. First score for Plainview.
And then Cambridge came right back, answered that score with a touchdown of their own from Wade Vaunce. That tied the game at six. But Plainview, Damon, just a steady diet of work on the ground. And that Plainview offense really doing exactly what they want to do, run the football.
Yeah, they did. They proved that no matter what kind of skill players you have, if you can't control the line of scrimmage, it doesn't matter. And right now, they're winning the line of scrimmage battle.
The fake extra point results in a two-point conversion. Cambridge has had opportunities in the passing game, but just missing on some big moments. And then at the end of the half, and we'll keep an eye on the health of Wade Vaunce, he took this hit from Harrison Lingenfelder.
Harrison Lingenfelder, exactly. Again, as we said earlier on, Harrison at 6'4 and 265 pounds, just drilled Vaunce. And here are the numbers. We talked about that rushing yardage earlier.
Cambridge 3-for-8 in the passing game. Nobody's turned it over yet on the scoreboard there, although there was the muffed punt that cost Cambridge some yardage and an opportunity. 156 rushing yards on 27 carries, David. Plainview doing just what they want to do.
Yeoman's-like work. That's impressive right there, churning it out.
And the Plainview Pirates have churned out a 14-6 lead here at halftime in this Class C2 state championship as the fans. It's a chilly afternoon. The wind's making it a little bit chillier, and that wind has picked up just a little bit, blowing pretty steadily now and creating a few problems for some of the fans who don't have a cup of coffee or hot chocolate in their hands. They're at the concession stands getting warmed up and getting ready for the second half. That second half coming in just a moment. The Class C2 title game continues next.
164 yards on the ground. You've really dominated the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, we have. That's one thing we wanted to come out and do is establish our ground game, and we did that. And towards the end of the quarter, they made some adjustments that shut us down a little bit. But, you know, we talked about some things we think we can take advantage of in the second half. So, you know, that's what we'll try to do.
And defensively, slowing down Vaunce is the key, but he's proven to be tricky.
Yeah, I mean, he's a great quarterback. You know, no lead safe by any means with him back there. So we got to keep getting pressure and not allow any of those deep routes.
Thanks, Joe.
All right, thank you.
Well, they've done exactly what they wanted to do, Damon, and that is evident. And I'm guessing we'll see a lot of the same in this second half. What was the quote from Joe Anderson before the game? We have a lot of close games because we want to have a lot of close games.
He says, you know what, their style tends to keep teams in the game because they like those long, sustained drives. And Cambridge is getting a dose of that. I'm curious to see who makes the next chess move. We saw Cambridge move into the 4-4 look. Slowed Plainview down a little bit. And I think Plainview's going to have to come back and say, okay, with four linebackers and three in the secondary, do we want to get away from what we do well, or do we want to take advantage of some of the matchups? And conversely, if Cambridge catches the football and maybe takes advantage of some of the guys that they've had open, we're not even having this conversation.
Plainview runs the ball well between the tackles. It's just a question of Damon whether or not they can counter the four-man front, the four backers, with getting out to the edge quickly with speed. And they don't have blazing speed. They just certainly have workmanlike speed and workmanlike quickness. So we'll see how it all unfolds here. We want to correct. I'm still a bit perplexed by the statistics here. Our official stats show 115 yards. I think 164 is over there on the far board. So we'll clear that up here in a moment and get the second half underway. We're talking about Plainview rushing.
Well, if you'd like to get yourself a DVD of today's C2 title game or any of our state championship football or volleyball games, we've got a very easy way or two for you to do that. Log on to the netnebraska.org website, click on the sports link, or call 1-800-228-4630. Get yourself a memory that will last for years to come. NET is Nebraska's home for sports.
Kevin, I just took a look over across the way, and Wade Vaunce up and throwing the football looks pretty good. He took that huge, huge hit from Harrison Lingenfelder right on the final play of the first half, but he's over there. He looks like he's okay, lucid, clear, throwing the football well, moving around well. So thank goodness for that, and he's ready to play here in the second half.
That's good news. It will be Plainview with the football to start this second half as Cambridge won the toss. They elected to receive to start off this game, and so it will be Plainview who gets the chance to start off with the football and the lead 14-6 here to start this third quarter. And for Plainview, see what their move is against Dan Keyser and the Cambridge Trojans.
And
be a very exciting second half. We've had a lot of fun in this first half, and looking forward to seeing what happens in half number two. Don't forget, tonight at 7 o'clock, we've got yet another class of high school football to crown a champion. It's Class A tonight, Millard North and Lincoln Southwest. That's a 7 o'clock Central Time kickoff tonight, right here on NET1 and NETHD. Lincoln Southwest and Millard North, whole crew, Adrian, Damon, Larry, me, our entire NET sports crew will all be here for that one. Hope you will be as well. Wade Vaunce really does it all. He's ready to kick it off. And Vaunce approaches the football with a 14-6 deficit for his team, the Cambridge Trojans. A little bit of a squib kick, trying for a quick recovery, and it is scooped up, fortunately for Plainview, and good coverage on that from Jack Pudens, the senior, able to cover it up as Cambridge trying a little bit of trickery to get that football back to start the second half. Plainview with good field position at the 32-yard line. That's where they'll start, first down and 10, leading 14-6. Blake Mosel, the quarterback, hands off. A little bit of a trouble with the handoff. Rogge able to secure it, and he moves it from the 32 to a 33-yard line, gain of just a yard for David Rogge.
Vaunce made the hit that time from his linebacker spot. Squared up on the ball carrier and able to knock him down just after that 1 yard gain. So appears he's all right. He's ready and able to play.
Second down and 9. Just underway in this third quarter. Mosel to throw. Floats it out. Catch is made at the 40 yard line by Keelan Anderson. And Anderson is stacked up right there. Moved it ahead close to the 41 before shoved back. They'll give him forward progress, and he'll be 2 yards shy of the first.
We talked earlier about the next chess move, and here it is. They flood the flats with only 3 people in the secondary. The flats are what you leave vulnerable, and right away Plainview goes to it with the play action pass. The backers step up. You slip the back right behind the backer. Easy pitch and catch here to a guy that I'm kind of becoming a fan of here in Keelan Anderson, who's done it all for the Plainview Pirates.
Third down, about a yard and a half for the first. Play fake, Mosel on the roll. He's in trouble. Nice move by Mosel to get away from the first man, but he will not get away from the second. Good ankle tackle by Brett Crivelli to stymie the Plainview offense, and it's fourth down.
Brian Ballou is the young man who is coming on to play 31. See him, the linebacker right there? He's coming through the gap, not able to make the tackle, but slowing everything down, just putting a big wrench into the play to slow things down and get help from his friends to make the tackle.
Got a receiver out there. I didn't see one. That was a, looked like a design run the whole way. Receiver with a little crackback block.
Crivelli and Lytle back to return this punt. On one hop, Lytle has it at the 35. Across the 40, and Lytle down to the 42-yard line, and that's where Cambridge will start, first down and 10.
Am I the only one interested in why Lytle hasn't carried the ball from the running back
spot? I was just going to bring that up, Damon. He's got 1,079 yards rushing on the year and 129 carries, and no carries so far today.
I'm a little surprised by that. I was looking forward to seeing him with the football under his arms a little bit today.
So far, guys, it's been all Wade Vaunce.
Well, congratulations, our Nebraska Public Power District football trivia question. The correct answer from Fred. That's all we know about Fred. But Fred, congratulations. Fred knew that in 1991, Wood River's Scott Frost made a 105-yard interception return for a touchdown against Burwell. The Nebraska State High School football trivia quiz, sponsored by Nebraska Public Power District. Always there when you need us. And Scott Frost will be joining us here tomorrow on the broadcast. And the prize, of course, for Fred, a beautiful, stylish NET Sports athletic gray T-shirt and the NET Sports ceramic mug as seen on Big Red Wrap-Up. Now, if that won't be a conversation starter, I don't know what will. Congratulations, Fred.
Kevin, it was seen until Matt Davison showed up the other night.
Yeah, Davison's a somewhat of a thief, but we won't go into that. I'd hate to impugn his otherwise good character. It's Speaking of good character, here's Larry Putney.
It's nice of you to say. You know, you were mentioning Anthony Lytle, wondering why he has not carried the ball yet. In addition to being a great running back, rushed for more than 1,000 yards this year, he's also a terrific singer. In fact, he tried to make All-State Choir as a junior. Came up a little short, but as a senior, he tried out for the All-State Choir. He made it and was so excited to perform in the All-State event. Went to all the practices, and now, because of this state championship game, he's going to miss one practice. So the state association has said he cannot sing in All-State Choir because he's going to miss one practice playing in this game.
Well, that's too bad for a young man that was really excited about that opportunity as the lateral bounces over and is covered by Brett Crabelli. Loss of two back to the 40-yard line. It'll be second and 12. You feel for a guy like Lytle. What are you going to do? You're a senior. You're not going to skip the state championship game. It's too bad he can't do both.
Tough to be penalized for being good at two things.
Second down and 12 from the 40-yard line. For Belly and Keener split out wide to the right side on second and 12. Pump fake Vaunce on the roll. Pressure coming, throwing for Keener over the middle, and it's tipped and intercepted. The interception up the near sideline to the 45-yard line, and more. A flag is down at the end of the play, and what a tip and what an interception. Mosel returns it to the 46. We'll wait and see about the flag, but the first big turnover of the day comes into the arms. Well, the second recovered by Plainview after the muff punt. The illegal block will cost him some yardage, but what an athletic interception and a great tip.
Wade Vaunce under pressure that time, lets it fly, and Brett Groff is a guy who gets a hand on it here. Here comes the pressure. He feels it, he sees it, and now Groff, number 24, tips it right into his teammate's hands, and now it's head upfield.
That's a tough break for Vaunce. Relatively well thrown ball. Keener's got to go up and try to make a play. First man in the air usually wins the war. DB got up off the ground before Keener did, and the result is an interception.
Watch the penalty right there in the middle of your screen. And that's too bad.
Yeah, Shiflett's lucky he didn't get hurt on that play. His knee buckled underneath him there on that block.
So Plainview gets the interception. The penalty pushes them back to the 33-yard line. That's where they'll start first down and 10. And Rogge just about snuck through that hole. Ends up with a 4-yard gain. Out to the 37-yard line where it'll be second and 6.
I wonder how many bullets Cambridge can dodge here. They're undersized. They've hung in there thus far, but Plainview size has got to wear on you eventually.
Eventually it does, David. And the other part of that equation is how many more bullets can Wade Vaunce take as a quarterback? He got popped again on that last play.
Second down and 6 from the 37. Mosel on the roll, floats it out for Keelan Anderson. He has it. Nice catch. And down to the 49-yard line. 13-yard pickup and a first down.
Again, working the edges with that Cambridge defense stacked in there the way it is. And Keelan Anderson, watch him kind of waving his arm here, saying, here I am, let me have the football. Maybe we'll get a shot at it. Well, just before that, he was waving his arm because actually it looked like 31 Ballou in the way right there, but he waved that arm up, and Mosel able to see that and then just drift the ball right up over his head, and he makes the catch.
From the 49-yard line, first down and 10. Straight ahead run for Keelan Anderson. Across midfield and just the nose of the football into Cambridge territory. And Joe Anderson, the head coach of Plainview, in his fourth year, we asked him what his team does well.
Scrimmage is so far. We don't do anything flashy. You know, we're big up front, and we'd be able to kind of control the line of scrimmage. We haven't had a lot of super big plays. We've kind of grinded it out a lot of years, or most of the games. So that's why a lot of our playoff games have been fairly close. You know, we're not some of the big chunks. You know, we've kind of grinded at people, and our up front was where we kind of got it done.
A screen pass out to Brett Groff, and Groff down to the 40-yard line for a first down for Plainview. The passing game coming out of mothballs for Plainview in this third quarter.
And working the edges, David, as we talked about earlier.
As we take a look at the replay, this is excellent coaching. Plainview has made the decision that Cambridge is going to choose their poison and try to be stout inside. And so Coach Anderson says, okay, we're going to work the edges. And he's got that flat, those flat areas are going to be there for the taking against that 44 look.
Good hole for Rogge, and Rogge still on his feet, makes his way to the 33-yard line, a 7-yard pickup for David Rogge. And get the feeling this Plainview offense starting to go downhill a little bit here.
Roggie coming to the right side again behind all the big trailers over there on that right side behind Kluver and Ligenfelder and Anderson. And then he's got a lot of power. This guy impresses me. We said he was over 100, and the stats have not been updated. Well, they were updated in the wrong direction here earlier on, so we'll try to guess at it, but he's got to be over 100 yards now, just surmising. But he runs hard. He runs very, very hard. Of course, he's staying right behind the big boys up front there.
Bit of a throwback, too. No gloves, no sleeves.
No socks.
He's just out there toughing it.
Second and three. Gets the carry again. Roggie fighting his way forward near the 30-yard line. Stacks up about a half a yard shy, it looks like, of the first down. So it'll be third and short for Plainview. Midway through this third quarter, Plainview holding on to a 14-6 lead and looking for more as they get ever closer to that red zone.
Tell you, Cambridge has got to be thinking, now that Plainview's working north to south, they've got to keep them out of the end zone from scoring six. A field goal would be awful difficult into this breeze.
Third and short, Keelan Anderson. Big hole to rumble through again, and Anderson with more than enough for the first down at the 23-yard line of Cambridge, first and 10 for the Pirates of Plainview.
And he just continues to impress. Keelan Anderson taking it right straight up the middle, right over Meyer and Kluver this time. Roggie, a 2,500-yard ball carrier the last 2 years, and Keelan just getting his share of the carries and the yardage here this afternoon.
From the 23, first down and 10. Over the right side, Roggie with running room. Another close to a first down run as he takes it down near the 12-yard line of Cambridge.
In the stats, those yards will go to Roggie, but your guy, Adrian, Keelan Anderson with a tremendous lead block that sprung this play. Wiry frame, too, for Keelan. Says here he's 6'3", 180. Not the prototypical size for a guy that's doing what he's done out here today.
Just mentally tough, physically tough, David, and playing a smart football game thus far. He, along with the people up front, Luke Ligenfelder, Sean Meyer, Jace Kluver, Harrison Ligenfelder, and Chase Anderson.
First down and 10 from the 12-yard line. Roggie gets the carry once more, working that right side. This time finding the running room more difficult to come by, as at the bottom of that pile for Cambridge, a couple of folks in there, including number 61, Davin Doyle, who helped out to make the stop.
Alluded to Keelan Anderson's wiry frame. He's got a Kevin Kugler type build.
Yeah, it drives the ladies mad. It really does.
Built like a straw.
But a sturdy straw, David. Very sturdy. Stiff breezes won't knock. Well, anyway. Second and 9 from the 11-yard line. Quick pass out into the flat. Hamilton trying to find running room. Good closing speed from Cambridge's defenders. We saw Breck Crabelli out there to close very quickly, and also Wade Vaunce to help make that stop. That play looked like, Damon, it might go somewhere, but they had great closing speed.
It did. As we take a look at the replay here, when this pass was initially thrown, I'm thinking they've got him out number 2-1, but good job of getting off the block here by Vaunce, who is an awful tough matchup out there for a smaller wide receiver. Good job by Vaunce in keeping that play to a one-yard gain.
Third down and 9 from the 11. Mosel on the roll. Throwing a little bit low and incomplete. Intended for Brett Groff at the 5-yard line. And that'll bring up a fourth down and 9 from the 11. Field goals 1-for-2 this year. Michael Stelling, his long is 25. So a field goal would be a difficult proposition, but I believe they're going to give it a try, and they are.
Stiff wind blowing, as we said, out of the northwest. You heard Larry Putney talk earlier in the ball game about what effect that wind has down there. That's straight out of the northwest. He'll be kicking right into it.
So Stelling, the junior, he'll mark this ball down at the 19-yard line. 29-yard try for Stelling, and the kick is no good. Just off to the right. And a big defensive stand for Cambridge. Plainview looked like they were starting to put everything in motion on the march. The defense stiffened, and we've still got a ball game here in this third quarter.
If you're keeping count, how many lives is that for Cambridge? They're hanging. They've been a resilient bunch. We'll see if they can put a drive together here and give their defense a chance to catch a breather.
Ball had plenty of distance, guys, but just a little bit offline. Actually, right into the wind offline.
First down and 10 from the 20. Straight ahead give to Lance Shiflett. And Shiflett ahead for a yard. Cambridge doing a lot of different things offensively today as Shiflett still the main man carrying the ball. We have not seen a carry yet out of Anthony Lytle.
I have a feeling before the day is over, if they want to get back in this thing, number 30 is going to have to make a play.
Lytle ends up split out wide left this time. On second and 9, Shiflett the lone man in the backfield, and right straight ahead again. Wade Vaunce with the quick snap and just pushes forward for 6 yards to the 27-yard line.
Once again, he recognized that wider split. Lots of room to run, and you said it, Kevin. He ran on the quick snap. Don't waste any time up there. You see that, take it. Maybe you bust one loose, but it'll be a third down and a long 3 yards to go here.
14-6, Plainview leading over Cambridge in this C2 title game. Vaunce in the shotgun. He'll run on the quarterback sweep out of the gun. He's got the first down and brought down at the 32-yard line. Tackle made out there for Plainview by Brett Groff. Vaunce able to get the first.
Again, getting athletes out in space. Little option sweep here with the lead blocker.
Spread formation, right side, right, Damon, and run all the way. He's going all the way with the run, but they spread the formation out, made it look like perhaps they might throw the football, spread the defense, and then come back with a run by Vaunce.
Trips lining up left of the line. First down play, the give ahead to Shiflett. And Shiflett with a 3-yard pickup, tackled by Derek Getz for Plainview. And they'll mark him down actually at the 34, so it'll be second down and 8 yards on the play.
Second or third time that Plainview's been misaligned on that trips to the boundary. See if Cambridge has noticed that somewhere up in the booth where they can maybe take a look at coming back to that to the boundary here for a big play opportunity.
Second down and 8 from the 34. On the option, tough pitch, Lytle with his first carry and a stiff arm, but cannot get out of the grasp of Philip Hamilton. Boy, what a tough pitch to get. Lytle made a nice catch and moved it ahead for positive yardage.
This was an absolutely incredible pitch. Fake that dive. That might be one of the longest pitches on an option I think I've seen in a long, long while. But again, Hamilton there coming up in run support and making a great play on Lytle. Lytle is an extremely good back, very quick back, very fast back. And Hamilton able to deal with him one-on-one in open field.
Third down and 6 from the 36-yard line. Vaunce to throw. Has a man open and incomplete at the 45-yard line. Lytle was there, but it'll be fourth down.
A little too much pressure there caused the incompletion. Lytle was wide open there with a little hitch route here for the first down.
See Vaunce again, and here comes the pressures you talked about, Damon.
The Kluver's just been a nightmare today, both offensively and defensively.
Kluver, the offensive center, terrific job up there, and then playing great defense. Senior at 6 foot, 225.
Vaunce ready to punt it away. Vaunce gets off a decent punt, driving it toward the sideline and out of bounds. Hamilton with no possibility for a return. And they'll mark this punt out of bounds near the 28-yard line. Let's go downstairs, check in with Larry Putney.
Well, thanks, Kevin. You know, Plainview's only had one other state championship. That came back in 1975, and you're looking at the guys who won the state title and Coach Warren Washburn. Now, not only did these guys win the title, but 30 years later, 4 of these guys have kids out here playing, trying to win a state championship today. Warren, what were these guys like for you?
They were great. They were a state championship team, undefeated, and just fantastic group to coach. Plainview's got a great tradition even before I got there, and they're continuing it.
John Anderson, your son Keelan is out there along with the boys from 3 of these guys, and I think a nephew back here is out there. What's it like to having played in a state championship and won it and now seeing your son out there?
Oh, it's just an unbelievable feeling. I never thought 30 years ago when I left the field I'd be seeing my son playing the state championship game. And he'll enjoy it. It'll be something I've never forgotten. And it's just a great day for the town of Plainview.
We brought these guys down to the field. They got a little closer to the action. All of a sudden, I thought they wanted to suit up. It was pretty intense. So congratulations, guys.
Thank you.
Well, no question that you get those juices flowing again if you've been in that state championship situation. They're ready to go again.
Kevin, it's always great to see how the family attitude of the, prevails in the small town atmosphere. Here's the play, but good to see that happen.
Roggy breaking free. David Roggy down the sideline. One man to beat. Roggy still on his feet. He's going to score. Nope, he's out of bounds. They mark him out of bounds at the 24-yard line. Thought for a minute he was able to walk the tightrope down the sideline, but Roggy out at the 24.
Josh Keener for Cambridge has some pretty keen eyes as we see Roggy just shedding people, just running like the bull that he is, maintaining balance here, Damon. Now here comes Keener, see number 7.
The thing I like here at the end of the run is Roggy's got no intentions of running out of bounds here. He's trying to get all he can get.
Headed for the zone.
And right back into his hands, Roggy headed back for that end zone direction, and he comes up with another 10-yard pickup from the 24 down to the 14. Another first down for Plainview, opening up some big holes now to run through for David Roggy.
Now, there's a reason he picked up 2,500 yards, almost 2,500 yards the last couple of years, and we're seeing that. Kid really runs well in traffic, keeps the feet going. Keeps the head down, a low target, low gravity. Excellent work.
First and 10 from the Cambridge 14-yard line. Roggy again. Roggy at the 5. Roggy into the end zone. The David Roggy drive capped off by a 14-yard touchdown run. And Plainview leads 20-6.
Tell you right now, Cambridge has got to be thinking that field slants from north to south right now. Plainview just running downhill.
Well, he gets good blocks up front by guess who? Kluver, Lingenfelder, Anderson. And then he gets by them. He gets by the line of scrimmage and he takes the tackler on all his own and knocks him out of the way and puts it in the zone. Here comes the extra point.
The try is up from Stelling and the extra point is good. Right down the middle for Michael Stelling. And Roggy carried the mail on that drive and he carried it all the way into the end zone.
Well, you see the blocks by the lineman, Lingenfelder in particular, and then Damon, I tell you what, this kid, you were talking earlier about Keelan Anderson, and he's a horse too. But Roggy sets it up here, just runs right through the tackle there.
I like how he goes into contact. He had that ball under his arms with the intent on scoring, and that's what you like to see out of your tailbacks in the red zone.
And he kept himself low to the ground, a small target, and he's compact, very strong on the run. Incredible.
There's a fan that likes it.
Well, those Plainview fans are pretty jacked up right now, leading 21-6. Would you and your business like to help bring programs like high school football and volleyball to NET television? You can become a corporate sponsor. Along with other Nebraska businesses, your contributions can support quality programming. Help support NET by calling 1-800-634-6788. We mentioned our trivia winner earlier, and we said it was Fred. We didn't know who Fred was. Fred Ivey is the Fred. He's the head football coach at Scribner-Snyder. Coached against Scott Frost. They lost last week to Plainview. Dan Kieser and Fred Ivey coached and played together at the then Kearney State. So Fred Ivey in Scribner is our trivia winner. And congratulations to Fred. Great to have Fred watching today as Cambridge brings it out to the 25-yard line with Lytle. And it'll be first down and 10 for Cambridge. And now a little bit of worry for the Cambridge Trojans, down 2 scores. And a minute 22 remaining in the third quarter. They need to get something going.
Yeah, earlier on, Kevin, when the score was 14-6, I was going to say that it looks like this game is really going to depend on who makes a mistake first, but not 21-6. Let's go down to Larry. Larry?
Here in 2003, it was tied at 14. Drive, about a 40-yard drive with 2 minutes left, and Vaughn's led the way all the way down when they beat Crofton and won that title in 03. This is the kind of kid who can bring a team back, and there's a throw that proves it.
Well, terrific throw under great duress. Brian Ballou makes the catch, and Vaughn's got sandwiched. You see, a little slow to get up. He got popped again as he threw that football.
Nicholas Yost, and this time he had the hammer.
See Yostin here in a second. Number 44 right there on your right side. Watch this. Boom. Lingenfelter also there, and then he goes down to the turf. So he gets hit to start with, and then takes another hit going to the turf.
It's odd to see them run three fake slip screens without running one slip screen just yet. And as we say it, here it comes.
And it's nearly intercepted. The ball incomplete. Almost picked off by Nick Yostin, who was out there and had a chance to pull that one in for a pick.
Two huge plays by Yostin, and what's significant about this play is you don't know if this is a pass or a lateral, so just play it out. He thinks maybe it's a lateral, so they go after the football. It could be a live football. That's good alert play because you just don't know. Just go to it, make the play, and then let the referee sort it out. Good play by Yostin.
That almost stayed up on the leg of Lance Shiflett before hitting the turf. Somebody had a chance to get it on the carom. Vaunce on second and 10 fires and dropped at the 45-yard line. Brett Crabelli, he's frustrated. He knows that that one hit him right between the two and the zero.
He's had a hard time putting a fork in it today. He bobbled the punt a couple of punts earlier and had a key drop before this one. And he's got some room to run here. He's thinking about real estate before he's thinking about securing the catch.
So third down and 10 now for Cambridge. And here comes a flag. Trojans with an illegal substitution. They had an extra man in the huddle, and that'll cost them five more, and it'll be third down and 15 now for the Trojans.
They've got 49 seconds left here in the third quarter, guys, to try to do something with the football with the wind at their back and behind by the two scores, as you said, Kevin, 21-6. See what they come up with here in the last 49 seconds.
Third down and 15 now. Crabelli splits out to the right, Lytle to the left. And the swing pass to Shiflett out of the backfield with Lytle blocking out in front. And Shiflett takes it into Plainview territory to the 48-yard line. That'll leave Cambridge 3 yards shy of a first down. Down 21-6 late third quarter. This might be go for it territory.
Absolutely, especially going against the wind in the fourth quarter. You got to take advantage of this field position while you've got it and hope something good comes out of it here on this fourth and three.
Crabelli and Keener out to the right of the line. Lytle in the slot, Vaunce in the gun. Vaunce on the quarterback keeper, and Vaunce is going to have a first down and much more. Vaunce across the 40, the flag down. Will tack on some yardage at the end of that run. Looked like a face mask. And Vaunce is going to have a first down for the Trojans.
Once again, they spread three receivers to the right side, giving you a passing look. And Vaunce comes up. Same play they ran earlier in the ball game, a couple of times, actually. And Vaunce, with his great ability to run the football, actually made that one look very, very easily, or easy.
I think the stiff arm was actually on Vaunce. I'm surprised that face mask went the other way as we take a look at the replay.
I think they just switched it, Damon.
There it is, right? Oh, that's kind of dicey. He didn't grab the face mask, but there was contact.
Awfully close to call.
They tacked this on at the end of the run and put him in about a fourth and 8.
It's a face mask, and it's going to go against Cambridge.
Because that is not close possession. Only of the five yard.
Yeah, incidental.
So either way, it'll be a first down for Cambridge. See it again.
Right on the grill, but just, yeah, that's really close. Really close.
Stiff arm, it's a lost art. I like guys that know how to use it.
Put him in the chest.
From the 42, though, it is a first down, and that was the goal of the play for Cambridge. They wanted that first. They got it. First and 10 from the 42. And Vaunce on the option keep. Vaunce takes it down to the 32-yard line. That'll be another first down. And that'll stop the clock with 19 seconds remaining in the half as they move the chains, and Cambridge on the move late third quarter.
Been able to manage the clock very well thus far, still 32 yards away from Pater. And 19 seconds to go with that, but managing the clock well.
Interesting ebb and flow to this game. You get the sense that Cambridge needs an uphill fight before they come out swinging. Got behind early.
Great drop for Vaunce. Fires, and the catch is made at at the 27-yard line for the final play of the third quarter, a 5-yard pickup. And Cambridge on the move at the end of quarter number three in this C2 title game. Plainview in the driver's seat, but Cambridge heading towards the end zone. The fourth quarter of the C2 title game is next. And renewable, making a difference for soybean farmers and you. There you go, as promised, you make a sign, we do our best to get you on TV. We've said that for years. Those young ladies listen. 21-6 as we start the fourth quarter of play in this Class C2 championship game. Plainview out in front of Cambridge. Cambridge facing a second down and five, along with Adrian Fiala, Damon Benning, Larry Putney. I'm Kevin Kugler. Second and five, misdirection. Lytle trying to find some running room. He's got some running room across the 20 and down to the 19-yard line. Anthony Lytle gets the first down for Cambridge and moves Cambridge into that red zone.
Interesting that we haven't seen him get more touches. He looks like he could be an exciting player with the football under his arms. He has a little bit of a burst. He seems like he's got pretty good vision. I'm shocked that that's his first carry.
Lytle will head out left of the line, and they'll split Fribelli out wide to the right. First down and 10 from the 20 for Cambridge, trailing 21-6. The belly option and right into the belly. The ball popped out. Who covered it? And it is covered, I believe, by Cambridge. So it'll be second down for the Trojans. They lose about a yard and a half back to the 21-yard line.
You're going to see Derek Getz here make the play, number 63. Blitz is coming by the backers. Backer gets chopped down, but there's Getz right away, able to remove the blocker and make a play.
Coach's worst nightmare is to see those beanbags come flying.
Big break for Cambridge to get that back, second and 11 from the 21. Vaunce on the keep, and Vaunce inside the 20 to the 17-yard line. It picks up four. That brings up third and long, third and seven for the Trojans from the 17-yard line. 10:45 to play, and this certainly the biggest play of the game thus far here for the Cambridge Trojans as they try to keep this drive moving.
Yeah, we talk about Vaunce's ability, and he's tough, he's durable. That last play there, he took a straight up smack right in the face by David Raggi on the tackle, and just got popped up and ready to go again.
Third down and seven. Vaunce, catch is made at the 10 and moving across the 10. That should be the first down. Lance Shiflett didn't have it when he first got hit, but he was able to drive forward, and it's first and goal for Cambridge.
Interesting thing about this as we take a look at the replay here is watch Vaunce stand in under pressure. I mean, he's under some duress here. He stands and delivers. Takes a little bit of a shot, but he got that ball in the tightest of spaces. And then a good job by Shiflett being shifty, shaking free for the first down.
Knew he had to get to that line, Damon, and he got there.
First down and goal. Nice catch by Fribelli. Ball pops out, and it's scooped up by Plainview. And the Pirates, with Philip Hamilton on the scoop, turn away Cambridge, a huge turnover on first and goal.
Fribelli has had trouble all day hanging onto the football, and once again, we'll see Fribelli here. He takes that quick pop pass out in the flat, and great job of stripping the football there. Was that Yostin?
Was.
Nicholas Yostin on the strip. He's played an excellent football game for Plainview, you betcha. And gives his team some new opportunity here.
From the 25-yard line, first down and 10. Raggi to the outside. Just when you think there's not much there, Raggi somehow finds 8 or 9 yards on that right side. Gets 8 to the 33, and it's second and 2. That's a nice piece of running.
Good piece of running, and it's a mistake, guys, that Cambridge makes that really eliminates a scoring opportunity. We talked about mistakes earlier and how in the last quarter here in a close ball game, how they become a factor. Well, it was a factor for Cambridge, obviously, because it looked like they had the momentum to take it in the zone, and they fumbled away.
Well, the turnovers have been costly for Cambridge today. Raggi over that right side out to the 35-yard line should be enough for a Plainview first down. 9:49 to play in this C2 state title game, and Plainview starting to think about that first trophy since 1975.
David, question for a running back. When you take the handoff there and you see that jam up in front of you, what's your thought? How do you react to that?
Well, a lot of times it depends on the down and distance, and I think right there he showed a good job of what I think most running backs would do in that situation. Second and short, you want to keep the chains moving. He found his blockers and put his head down.
If it's longer, if it's 7-8 yards?
You might want to look to make the big play, but I remember Coach Solich always talked a lot about patience and understanding the integrity of the play, and I think as a running back, you have a tendency to always want to think big play, but oftentimes, if you're patient enough and you take what's there, the big plays will come.
And you want to make sure you maintain ball security.
Absolutely, especially at this juncture in the game with 9 and counting.
Cannot afford the turnover here. Plainview hanging on to that 21-6 lead and starting to get into that critical juncture for a state championship. 2nd and 7 from the 38-yard line. Rogge to the outside, and Rogge wrapped up. Good tackle made for Cambridge by Brian Ballou, the outside linebacker who was able to get in there, wrap up Rogge on the play. It's 3rd down and 8 with 8:38 to play.
Defense got the opportunity that time because the lead blockers on the play just went too wide to start out with the play. They didn't maintain the relationship they needed to maintain with the runner. And the defense able to sneak right behind him and make a play for no gain.
Really admired Plainview's toughness and their commitment to the running game. They've been extremely patient with it.
3rd down 8. Mosel to throw. Now he's going to tuck it and run. Mosel across the 40. Oh, what a hit at the 43-yard line. Combining Mason Jackson and Wade Vance. And Mosel got leveled at the 42, well short of the first down.
That's why they call it football, guys.
It is a contact sport. As he gets to the edge, you think he sees the first down, but then once his feet stop, usually dead feet, dead ball carrier. That's usually the way it goes. Once your feet stop moving, you're asking for trouble.
Yeah, you're giving a guy like number 40 right there, Mason Jackson, an opportunity, and man, did he take advantage of the opportunity to lay a lick on the quarterback.
Plainview's got to hurry. The play clock down to 3, and a timeout's going to be called. Joe Anderson knows, hey, we're not so rushed. We've got the lead. Let's not screw up this punt and give Cambridge a short field here. Take our time, get set, get the punt off, and try to pin Cambridge down deep, trailing 21-6. Larry Putney's somewhere here in Memorial Stadium. Larry?
Well, Kevin, we talked about after 26 years on the sideline, this being Dan Keyser's last game. And despite his 7 championships, he says his best memory on the sideline was in this game, 1992 in Bloomfield, taking on one of Gary Walling's enormous teams. You know, Cambridge had no offensive linemen in this game over 200 yards. Walling had about 4 guys over 230. The Cambridge team came into the year thinking they may be 500 on the season, but what a great state championship this game this was. Cambridge lost it 21-20. Bloomfield won it, but it's Gary Walling's best memory as a head coach.
Now, Coach Keyser's had a lot of great moments. He's got another 7:27 here in the fourth to try to make a final great moment as a head coach.
Cambridge needs their special teams to be special here.
It's a short kick. And a bounce at the 30-yard line. Take a little bit of a Cambridge hop and then a big Cambridge roll out near the 40-yard line. So special teams didn't do a whole lot, but they got a kind roll from the field here at Memorial Stadium and set up in good field position with 7:16 to play.
And that's kind of the key right now is time, Kevin, at 7:16, behind by 15 points. You've got to get one down the field here relatively quick. You don't want to get into that, what I always look at, the 5-minute, 10-point rule. That's my little personal rule. But again, it's close to that, and a quick score here would certainly help their cause.
First down 10 from the 39. Shiflett empties out the backfield, going in motion. Vance on the move to the left, now throwing on the run, deep downfield, and fighting for the ball. The catch is made by Lytle, and he's down to the 18. Lytle just pulled it away, and Cambridge is in business again.
Johnny on the spot. I talked earlier, if Cambridge was going to get back into this game, that number 30 was probably going to be the guy that had to make a play. And here he is as we take a look at Vance being elusive, especially for a big guy, gets his shoulder squared.
Watch Hamilton here. Hamilton thinks he's got an interception, actually. Ball a little bit underthrown, but Damon, as you know, as a receiver, you got to fight for the football, and that's what he did.
First man in the air wins the war. He was the first one to go up and get it.
But the DB there, Philip Hamilton, really thought he had an interception.
First down, pressure coming, floating it over the middle, and it is tipped away, incomplete. Again, it was Philip Hamilton with the tip. That ball tantalizingly up there in the air for anybody to grab.
Lots of pressure coming straight up the middle, Kevin, as you called it. Everybody's stemming and stunting. There comes Yostin, Ligenfelter. A whole group of people right around the football, and Hamilton this time knocks it away.
Seemed like it hung up there forever.
You've got to like this matchup here with Lytle here at the bottom of the screen. A lot of space out there.
That's where Vance is looking. Throws to Lytle, and it is intercepted at the 5-yard line. Back up the near sideline comes Brett Groff to the 40. Groff finally down at the 47-yard line. Lance Shiflett makes the stop. But a huge pick for Groff as Plainview turns Cambridge away again.
The junior got underneath the receiver that time and picked up off his fifth pass of the season. And you don't play it much better than this. Damon, as you were saying, trying to get the ball to Lytle, but man, he got underneath the receiver. I think something happened on the route right there.
A lot of real estate down there to work with to bring that route so far inside.
It looked almost like Lytle was going off the route a little bit there.
First down carry for David Aragi, and a 2-yard pickup from the 48 to midfield. Plainview leading 21-6, and we've talked a lot about this offense and the ground attack today for Plainview, but boy, that defense has stepped up to some big time challenges, especially in the second half.
They have. Every time Cambridge came a knocking, Plainview, they answered. They weren't letting them in. That's for sure.
Joe Anderson talked about his defense being very good against the run. Today, Cambridge, just 86 yards thus far.
Roggy again, ball security. He seemed wrapping up with both hands as he came over the left side. We've got a flag down right at the end of the play. And a little bit slow to get up. Josh Keener, he's all right, and we'll check out the flag. And it'll be a hold against Plainview, so that'll cost him 10.
After all these carries by Roggy, he'd be the last guy that I wanted to see if I'm that Cambridge defense. He's got to be approaching somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 carries.
30 carries and, probably, 150 probably?
You might be on the low end, but I'm sure you're in the neighborhood.
150 to close to two, somewhere in the 150 to 200 range.
Stadium scoreboard says 288 rushing. I'm sure he's accounted for at least half of that.
Yeah.
He is a load.
326 rather, the yardage, total yardage today for Plainview. Cambridge with 244, but just as Adrian mentioned, 86 on the ground. Third and 10 from the 48-yard line. Toss play, short side of the field to Keelan Anderson. Anderson stays in bounds and down to the Cambridge 46-yard line. We'll bring up a fourth down for Plainview, and Plainview will bring on their punter Tom Johnson, likely boot this one away, try to pin Cambridge deep and give them the long field.
Notice on that last snap there was about 8 seconds left before, when he snapped the football. You would expect guys that you can run that baby down about maybe three or four. Let's see what happens on this play here. If the punter will run the clock down, it's clicking at 14, 13, 12 right now. Well, there is no punter. They're going to go.
Brought him on. They brought him right back off. Fourth down and four from the 46-yard line. And now they're going to do a quick kick, a wobbler. It'll take a nice roll for Plainview inside the 20 and rolling inside the 15 down near the 14-yard line. A little bit of a quick kick, fumbled by Roggy, then he booted it away and got a kind roll. So they did turn the field. Cambridge has got a long way to go to try to get back into this, and only 4:39 to play.
Almost outsmarted themselves there.
That sleight of hand almost turned into a slight mistake.
And we're below your danger territory here. The five minute ten point. Mark, that's good. I might have to use that. I kind of like
keep,
that.
Keep that file. It seems to, you know, you go back and you look. I've looked a lot of games, and here's a play.
Vaughns will throw on first down. Down the sideline, looking for Lytle. He's got it at the 35 and out of bounds near the 39 yard line. Anthony Lytle becoming the playmaker that Damon's been looking for from him most of the day.
Well, they're keeping the ball, Damon, along the edge, along the out of bounds area. You got to do that, as we see it again here. Vaughns a good throw, plenty of time to throw.
Kept the ball in play, let his playmaker make a play. At this juncture in the game, that's what playmakers got to do. They've got to make plays.
Make plays, and a good Lytle, a good job to catch it, to get a couple extra yards, and then get out of bounds. 4:31 left.
Pressure coming. Vaughn standing in over the middle. Got two men out there, and it's tipped and incomplete. And here comes a flag. Benson and Shiflett both in the area, and the flag down.
It's going to be one of those odd calls. The pass interference was actually on the guy that I think the pass was not originally intended for, but I don't think the referees are trying to discern at this particular time in the game.
That's Alan Genovec there making the call against Plainview. We'll see it again. Receiver headed right up the middle. That's number 22, Shiflett. That's awfully close.
Bing, bing, bing. Bing, bing.
Yep.
Yostin, the defender on the play. And it'll put Cambridge at the Plainview 46-yard line. 4:24 to go in this fourth quarter. Cambridge trying to muster a rally here late in this ballgame. Down 21-6. Shiflett will motion out of the backfield. Vaughns over the middle. Catch is made by Keener. Sheds a tackle. Keener at the 25 and down inside the 25 at the 24-yard line. So Cambridge moving the ball 22 more yards through the air and a first down.
Great call by Cambridge, Damon. They caught him in blitz. Plainview coming with the blitz that time, and you see the backers coming, and they just caught him up inside. And we talked about that at the very first part of the game. Here they make the play to get it downfield just inside the 25.
Oh, we have a sec while the whistle blows. I'm surprised that it's taken Cambridge so long to get back to that formation where they empty it with the backfield motioning out. They've got a couple of different options, either up the seams or to the tailback out of that very same look.
From the gun, first down and 10. Vaughns floating it towards the end zone, incomplete. Brett Crabelli, his intended receiver. And that one just a little too far for Crabelli to get a hand on. 4:07 to play in this fourth quarter. Cambridge trailing 21-6. Both of these teams 10-2. Plainview looking for its first title since 1975. And you met the title team if you were with us earlier. Larry had the chance to chat with the coach and some of the guys who played on that last title team. There's the empty backfield again. Here comes pressure. Vaughns steps up, catches made at the 20, and he'll go no farther. Ballou with the reception. And Keelan Anderson with the tackle for Plainview.
Great recognition by Anderson here on the play. Short gain creates third down. Pressure is coming, as you said, Kevin, and now Anderson, he had this thing diagnosed. About a 4-yard gain on the play.
Third down and 7 from the 20. 3:33 to play. Shiflett empties out to the left. They pump fake. Vaughns in trouble. Steps away from one man, throws, and that'll float about 8 yards deep on the sideline. And it'll bring up a fourth down. Vaughns has been under siege for most of this second half, and it started really at the end of the first half.
Coach Anderson is saying, thank goodness for pressure, because this play was there. He missed everything today. Rogge on the blitz.
He gets
and he
hit
just takes
again.
A shot, another shot.
That was Luke Lingenfelter.
Lingenfelter tattooed on his forehead by the end of this day.
A double trouble from both ends.
He's going to be dreaming about the number 74 and 68 for a long time.
Can you go to the store and get a Lingenfelter sandwich?
This week alone, NET Sports covered all 6 Nebraska State High School volleyball championships. We also televised the nation's number 1 volleyball team fight back from a 2-game deficit to beat Missouri in an exciting and emotional win. And then there's our weekly Husker football recap, Big Red wrap-up. And now we're here at Memorial Stadium with statewide coverage of the Nebraska State High School Football Championships. Up here in the booth, we're the face of NET Sports, but you don't get the chance to, normally to see the talented folks behind the scenes delivering the broadcast engineering, the pictures, the replays, the sound, the graphics, the program content. We've got the best crew in sports, I'm convinced of that. But what do you think? Do you like our performance? Do you enjoy NET's statewide coverage of Nebraska High School Championship and Collegiate Sports? Send us an email. We'd love to hear from you. sports@netnebraska.org. Drop us a line via the mail as well if you'd just like to put pen to paper. NET Sports, P.O. Box 83111, Lincoln, Nebraska, 68501. All of your comments are appreciated. Even if you've got something that you'd like to say that's not that complimentary about our producers and directors, that's fine. They'll take it. Say nice things about us. Fourth and seven from the 20. Vaunce in trouble again. Vaunce is brought down from behind. Immediately pressure came in there, and it's Luke Lingenfelter who wraps up Vaunce on fourth down.
Two big plays right in a row by Luke Lingenfelter. Vaughn's trying to get outside, get upfield. Big guy, Luke Lingenfelter at 6'3", 215. David, he showed pretty good speed, pretty good quickness, pretty good agility to make that play.
Roy Williams would have been proud of that horsepower there. That must still be legal in high school. That was a heck of an athletic play by the big fella.
First down and 10 from the 26-yard line. Plainview ever closer to a state championship as the give goes to Rogge. He moves it ahead from the 26 to the 28-yard line, a pickup of two. Second down for the Plainview Pirates. They'll call it a 3-yard pickup. Ball not much past the 28-yard line. As you see, Rogge, look at those numbers. 35 carries, 222 yards, and two touchdowns. That's not a bad day.
Now he brought his lunch pail, he brought his hard hat, and he's played well on defense too. I tell you, 35 for 222, that's awful impressive.
Stayed behind the big boys up front, good shape, good cut.
Carry number 36 on the day, will add a couple of yards to that total. And now Cambridge will utilize a timeout to stop that clock with 2.5 minutes remaining in the fourth quarter. Plainview leading 21-6 in this C2 state championship.
That was a great football shot just there. We missed that. You see Rogge slinging spit away from his face mask. Bare knuckled out there. That kid is, he's played hard, played awful hard today.
The C2 single game playoff rushing record is still a long ways away. 333 yards. That's for any game in the playoffs. Have state finals records, at least in our immediate grasp, but imagine there's been too many performances, Aid, in a state championship game better than what we've seen from David Rogge.
Well, I was looking, Kevin, 333, Tim Peterson from Cambridge in 1979 is the rushing yardage record for C2. John McCardle, 343, Miller North a couple of years ago.
Third down and six from the 30. Rogge to the outside. And Rogge down to the 34-yard line. That's 2 yards short of the first down. And Cambridge will use a timeout to stop the clock with 2:21 remaining here in the fourth.
Keely Anderson trying to lead out in front for Rogge. And it's just tough when you always are looking at the front of a guy's jersey. That means you know he's running downhill and his shoulders are square. That's tough to handle.
Well, and this showed you why he's such a good runner right there, because he was basically tackled in the backfield, Damon, but able to maintain the balance and get away and head upfield and make yardage out of a busted play.
Well, it's great to have you all with us here from Memorial Stadium. I'm Kevin Kugler, Damon Benning, Adrian Fiala, Larry Putney down on the field here at Memorial Stadium, and just enjoying this Class C2 state championship game and all of our championship games here at Memorial Stadium. Don't forget the Class A game is tonight with Millard North taking on Lincoln Southwest at 7 o'clock Central Time. But it's a great time of year, and we're having a ball here today as Plainview closing in on that state championship, guys. It's been since 1975, and The Pirates very close to pulling one off here.
And Joe Anderson took over the program 4 years ago, had two losing seasons to start with, 8-3 then last year. Stepped up to 10-2 and the state finals this year. It looks like he's going to win his first state championship.
Impressive. Very, very impressive. Absolutely. Performance by his staff and his players out there today.
Fourth down and two. Tom Johnson into punt. And movement along that defensive line as Plainview got themselves set and a little bit anxious to try to get the block. Some movement up front, and that's going to cost Cambridge 5 yards, and it's going to give Plainview a new set of downs to try to run out this clock. Huge, huge play.
Sort of typifies the day if you're Coach Kieser and that Cambridge staff. Your team just has been a little bit off all day, and you couple that with the tremendous effort by Plainview, and you get a 21-6 score right now.
You throw that mistake right there in with Damon with the drop passes in particular today by the Cambridge offense, and maybe it's a different ball game, but Plainview has had a lot to say about that.
First down and 10 from the 39, and a yard gained by Rogge to the 40-yard line. But yardage not that important. Plainview able to just run. Cambridge has no more timeouts. Plainview can make that clock shrink away and get ready to celebrate what looks like it's going to be a C2 state championship. It'll be their first ever C2 title. The title they won in 75, they were still in C1. So it's been a long time since a trophy came home to Plainview.
Take a look at that. I'm remembering that interview this morning, that the kind of half grin that Coach Anderson had as he was talking to the media. He was sly like a fox. He kind of knew what his team was capable of doing, and maybe we didn't as a crew, because I am a little bit surprised at this score right now. But he very much spelled out how his team likes to win football games, and he built us the blueprint.
Keelan Anderson right out near the 45-yard line, a 5-yard pickup, third down for Plainview. And nothing Joe Anderson said was a surprise to, well, when we've watched this game, everything that he said would happen is pretty much what's happened for Plainview today. They've done it exactly the way he outlined.
He's extremely forthright and candid with his comments, and it's very much the way his team plays, isn't it?
His disposition, personality, very much like the performance on the field. Very straight up. We're just going to come straight at you and make it work one way or the other. Nothing fancy. There's that exploding American or Maryland eye.
And Keelan Anderson exploding for the first down, Aid, and that ought to do it for Plainview. So the Plainview Pirates have not celebrated a state championship since 1975, and they're about to knock off one of the perennial powers in C2, the Cambridge Trojans, to get that title.
In an era right now and in a state where passing seems to be the fancy and everybody talks about multifaceted offenses, we'll see a couple of teams here, not only today and tonight, but tomorrow, that have made their living on the ground simply being tougher than the opponents that they go against.
And there is the bottles of water for Joe Anderson, the former South Dakota Coyote, and now all Pirate, as he ends up a state champion. And that has to be cold. But it feels good to him. And one more knee, and that will do it. Plainview begins the celebration as the Plainview Pirates will head out of Memorial Stadium, champions of Class C2, your C2 champions, Plainview Pirates. They win it today and win their first state championship since 1975. Your final score, Plainview 21 and Cambridge 6.
And a Plainview team, Kevin, that really played excellent defense today, a defense that we thought perhaps would show up, and they showed up very, very well. They went against the Cambridge team, averaging 362 yards on the season. They got 289 today. And then you can't say enough, Damon, as you said, about David Rogge and the game he had.
Absolutely. Plainview was extremely plain Jane, and it was good enough to win the day. Extremely efficient. They took care of the football. And they really typify kind of how football should be played. Extremely close to the vest, hardworking, They were tough out there today.
State champions in Class C2. The Plainview Pirates, they rule the day today. We'll crown the champions and dry off Coach Anderson next. NET Sports coverage of the 2005 Nebraska State High School Football Championships are brought to you in part by the Nebraska Public Power District, always there when you need us. By Education Quest Foundation, improving access to college through scholarships, community grants, and college planning services. By the Nebraska Soybean Board, promoting soy biodiesel fuel, clean burning, and renewable, making a difference for soybean farmers and you. And by Pepsi, a proud sponsor of the State High School Football Championships. The Plainview Pirates, your champions in Class C2 today, 21-6. The final score, Plainview, your champs in C2. And if you'd like to get yourself a DVD copy of today's game or any of our state championship football or volleyball games, we make it easy. Log on to netnebraska.org and click on the sports link or call 1-800-228-4630. Enjoy this memory and keep it for a lifetime. It's NET Sports, Nebraska's home for sports. Let's head to our public address announcer, Dwight Weiniger. He has the awards ceremony.
The Nebraska School Activities Association is honored to have medals and trophies for both of these outstanding teams. The award presentations will be made by NSAA Board of Control members Dr. Dallas Watkins from Dundee County, Glenn Morgan from Neely-Oakdale, and U.S. Bank representative Connie Dominski. Here are the awards for Class C2 runner-up Cambridge High School. Well, head coach Dan Keiser and your assistants, please come to the sideline stage to present the silver medals to the members of your team. Players, as your name is called, please come forward to receive your medal. Number 7, Josh Keener. Number 11, Jackson Johnson. Number 12, Wade Bonds. Number 14, Troy Hayes. Number 20, Brett Trabelli. Number 21, Cletus Mackey. Number 22, Lance Shiflett. Number 24, Bo Grabelli. Number 28, Alex Wusk. Number 30, Anthony Lytle. Number 31, Brian Ballou. Number 32, Daniel Craven. Number 33, David Campbell. Number 35, Andrew Carpenter. Number 40, Jesper Olison. Number 41, Mason Jackson. Number 45, Valmir Torres. Number 55, Jared Sewell. Number 61, Davin Doyle. Number 62, Taylor Lewis. Number 64, Jarrell Alexander. Number 67, Bronson Susie. number 69, Brandon Nickel. Number 70, Aaron Cove. Number 71, Jacob Brown. Number 73, Anthony Hopkins. Number 74, Dustin Webb. Number 76, Jacob Langley. Number 78, Paik Hilker. Number 79, James Hobbs. Number 82, Jacob Benson. Number 88, Dylan Mowry. And now, here's the 2005 Class C2 Runner-Up Trophy. Congratulations, Cambridge High School.
The Cambridge Trojans wrap up the career of Dan Keyser, the head coach of Cambridge. Unfortunately for Cambridge, they fall short in the title game, but it does nothing to diminish the tremendous career of Dan Keyser as a head coach in the state of Nebraska. 7 state championships, 9 appearances in all in the title game, and the Cambridge Trojans, they don't win the game, but certainly Dan Keyser goes out as a winner in his coaching career. He'll become the principal next year.
Tremendous effort by Keyser, his staff. He'll turn the program over to Josh Graves. He will run the program beyond this, but Keyser will be close to the action. Kevin, he's principal at Cambridge, so great career, 17 years, Dan Keyser, and we say thank you to Dan for all that he has done for high school football and wish him the very, very best as he moves into his administrative career.
Well, exciting times in the town of Plainview, and to crown the champions, we head back to our public address announcer, Dwight Weininger.
And now to the champions from Plainview High School. First, head coach Joe Anderson, we have a special award for you. And now, coach, would you and your assistants hand out the gold medals to the members of your championship team? Players, as your name is called, please come forward to receive your medal. Number 1, Trey Boyer. Number 3, Garth Forbes. Number 4, Elliot Van Kirk. Number 5, Grant Rutledge. Number 6, Brady Wills. Number 7, Brett Korth. Number 9, Blake Mosel. Number 11, Tom Johnson. Number 17, Philip Hamilton. Number 20, Tyler Holton. Number 21, Keelan Anderson. Number 22, Nathan Raggi. Number 24, Brett Groff. Number 25, Brett Clausen. Number 26, Jack Pudin. Number 28, Darren Forbes. number 30, David Rogge. Number 33, Caden Alexander. Number 34, Dalton Getzinger. Number 40, Jared Belts. Number 42, Michael Stelling. Number 44, Nicholas Yostin. Number 48, Joshua Scranton. Number 50, Eric Bird. Number 51, Ryan Miller. Number 52, Jace Kluver. Number 53, Jeremy Todd. Number 54, Chance Anderson. Number 55, Sean Meyer. Number 56, Tyler Johnson. Number 60, Nico Goble. Number 61, Trenton Halsey. Number 63, Derek Getz. Number 65, Alex Clark. Number 68, Luke Lingenfelder. Number 71, Joshua Kanofsky. Number 72, Leonard Reisinger. Number 74, Harrison Lingenfelder. Number 76, Adam Krueger. Number 77, Ethan Pellets. Number 78, Chaz Newhouse. Number 82, Brent Walken. Number 84, Seth Williams. Number 85, Dylan Zolke. Number 88, Lucas Sherrick. Number 89, Ryan Kudra. And now, for these outstanding athletes and their school, here is the 2005 Class C2 State Football Championship Trophy. Congratulations, Plainview High School.
A team that started the season 0-1 with a 13-7 loss bounces back to win the C2 State Championship. First time since 1975 that a Plainview Pirate football team has held a state championship trophy. Congratulations to the Pirates, finishing 11-2, and certainly the pride of Plainview right there.
Something to be said for a little fortitude and resolve, isn't it? Take you a long way in a lot of aspects of life, especially sports.
Well, they certainly showed that today.
Stellar defense today by the Plainview Pirates. Through the course of the season, 5 shutouts on the year, and they hold the Cambridge Trojans today to just 6 on the scoreboard. So, again, great defensive work And we always talk about guys' defense winning championships. We saw it happen today.
Joe Anderson, the head coach of the Champs, standing by with our Larry Putney.
Well, thanks, Kevin. Joe, a couple of years ago, you looked at these sophomores and you thought you'd give them a chance. You had a quarterback who was about 5'6", 120 pounds, dripping wet, but yeah. You gave them a chance. They went 1-7, slowly progressed. What's it like to have that dream kind of come true?
You know what? This is the best part of coaching, seeing those kids progress. It was so much fun. You know, it wasn't a great year, 1-7, 2-6 their first 2 years, but watching those kids get better as they get older and seeing them, coaches believed in them, they started believing in themselves, and, you know, we knew this could happen if they stuck with it. And credit them, they did.
After that 8-3 season, you had to be feeling like this was a possibility.
Absolutely. We had a good turnaround season. That really turned our program around last season. And we had a good senior class that came through last year that helped us get things on the right foot. And these guys learned a lot from them, and they stuck with it. And like I said, I can't say enough about them.
I think Damon Binning described your smile this morning and said you must have known something about the way your line can control a game.
You know, I knew they were capable. They're capable of doing it. Whether, you know, I knew Cambridge had tough linemen that really fired off the line of scrimmage hard. So I didn't know how well we could handle them up front. But, you know, like I said, they played super up front. Our fullbacks really led to the hole hard and ran hard. And I can't say enough about David, the way he ran.
Well, let's talk to David. 39 carries, 231 yards. What a terrific performance. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Tell us about what it's like to win the state championship.
It's pretty awesome, you know. We worked for it all year, you know, and it's just awesome to have everything pay off, you know.
You were given a shot a couple of years ago as sophomores. You all kind of played, got a little wet. You had some rough seasons. What's it like to be able to turn it around and come down here and win it?
It's, you know, it's a great feeling, you know. Just everybody puts in the hard work in the offseason and play hard, play as a team, you know. It's nice.
39 carries. Have you had that many before?
I don't know, maybe once or twice.
230 yards, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
The guy that opened it up for you, Harrison Lingenfelder. Harrison, congratulations.
Thanks, thank you.
So you just absolutely dominated that line in there.
I don't want to take it away from them. They're good guys, but, you know, I opened up holes for Rocky.
Has this kind of been what you've been doing all year long? I mean, dominating the line of scrimmage?
Yeah, I'd have to say. I don't want to be cocky or anything, but, I mean, that's, I've been kind of, you know, pushing guys around.
You guys play some tough football up there in Northeast Nebraska. You have Cedar Catholic and Creighton, which were 10-1, and C1, and you beat them. How does that get you ready for this type of atmosphere?
Oh, I mean, it's always a game. I mean, every game is a game. You just got to come ready. That's a huge thing of what we did. Like, when Hardington was as a close game, we were ready for that because we've played in those tough games. We've played in those close games.
So congratulations. As you look ahead, what might be ahead for you next year?
College football, but I don't know where. I want to keep playing.
No idea where.
No. Well, I got some schools interested, but if you guys are listening, send me some money.
We'll let you celebrate it. Congratulations.
Is that technically legal to send him money? I'm not sure. Harrison Lingenfelder. Yeah, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree with Harrison there. And it's great to see that young man's going to be successful wherever he ends up. And I'll echo those sentiments. Hey, if you're a college football program and you're interested in a guy who plays the game hard and is a great big body and obviously has a frame to put some extra muscle on there, it's not a bad guy to pick up, and he comes from good stock.
Absolutely. We saw his play today and all through the course of the year, Kevin. He really knows how to play the game. And it's great for me personally to see the innocence and the confidence that young man has and to see it at this level. Outstanding, and we wish him the best.
If you're listening, send me some money. Harrison Lingenfelder, the best laugh of the day today. Plainview Pirates, your C2 champions. Tonight, we've got another championship effort for you, and it should be a dandy. The Class A state championship as Lincoln Southwest in their first ever title game takes on Millard North tonight, 7 o'clock Central Time on NET1 and also in high definition on NETHD. It's the Class A state championship exclusively on NET Sports. Well, guys, we'll all reconvene here in a few hours, get set for that Millard North Lincoln Southwest game, but a dandy today as Plainview ends up state champs.
Absolutely, Kevin. Two teams that were well-drilled, well-schooled, and love to see that kind of play, Damon.
I've seen a lot of high school offensive lines this year, Class A, Class B. And I tell you what, I'd put this Plainview bunch from their technical standpoint and their work ethic right up there with anybody.
Well, it's a big line. It's a very mobile offensive line, an athletic offensive line, and a line that now can call themselves a state championship offensive line. Kudos once again to head coach Dan Keyser of Cambridge. A terrific final season for Coach Keyser, and we wish him the best of luck in his next phase of life as well. And congratulations to the C2 champs.